Good morning, everyone. I welcome you all to day two of Cube 2020. I am sure you had a wonderful day on day one, Cube 2020, and you learned a lot. Day two is fun filled and science filled as well. I invite now Suchita Dayanand, our senior colleague in Mindray, to start the proceedings. Thank you.
Good morning, all. So I wish that you had a great learning sessions yesterday. And lots of information has been shared and many of your questions have been answered. And with that, I welcome you all to the second day of Cube 2020. So we do have a first plenary session by Dr. Raymond Simon. Raymond is a very, very popular face in India. Most of them, the who's and who of hematology who are present here, okay, on this two-day sessions, all the faculties and many of the dignitaries know Raymond personally, and Raymond is my good friend. So I welcome Raymond to the plenary session. Raymond is associated with Mindray Medical, and today his topic of presentation is cell population data and data analysis. So while we are planning this Cube two-day event, we were discussing and debating over what kind of sessions should be keep and what kind of information that the people are looking for, you know, to implement in their own laboratory. And that's why the whole concept of, having a plenary session by Dr. Raymond came up, as he has worked extensively in data analytics and how all the cell population data, which is generated with this high-end analyzers, can be transferred and integrated with each other. And an algorithm can be made, and how then it can maybe be used in the future by integrating with your LIS and HIS. So I'm sure this is going to be very, very interactive and very informative sessions for all of us. Talking about Dr. Raymond, he is an expert in clinical and laboratory hematology, oncology, immunology, immunotherapy, coagulation, blood banking and flow cytometry, blood cell morphology and clinical hematology along with anemia. So Raymond himself is very, very much associated with the cytomorphometry, or actually hematocytomorphometry, for many years. Laboratory informatic systems, medical statistics are his area of interest, along with artificial intelligence. And I request Dr. Raymond to, take the session forward and share with all of us the entire plethora of information that he has about this data science, and enlighten us. Over to you, Dr. Raymond. Thank you.
Hello, thank you for inviting me for the Cube 2020 meeting. It's always a pleasure to collaborate with India. I have been many times here, and I have a lot of friends that I always remember, that you are in my heart. Today I am going to talk about cell population data, cytomorphometry in hematology. This topic is very important for me. In the early 90s, I began to investigate how to use these parameters, the leukocyte morphology, automated morphology, to improve the detection of diseases, or to exclude or to also include the normality and avoid false positive, both false positive and false negatives. And I am going to share with you some of the facts and how that plays a role in the actual hematology diagnosis. Let me share with you the presentation I prepared for this conference. Hematology diagnostic today. Today we know we have, this is one of the actual cell classifications that I modified, and here we can see the red cells, the platelets in the left, and today in the hematology analysis we have a lot of parameters about red cells and platelets, size, anisocytosis of both, but very few information about the leukocytes. The leukocytes only, we are happy if we can differentiate well them and flag abnormalities. But I will always love to have more than that, because leukocytes are, as we can see here in the graph, there are a lot of cells, and we don't count how many abnormal cells from this normal that we have seen here, we can see here, we can have. For this reason, I think it's very important to have much more information about granularity, size of the nucleus, size of the cell, etc., etc. What was the classification of the hematology till now? I think it was something like that. These are the big chronic lymphoproliferative disorders, in that we can see that for the diagnosis we use the morphology. Here, over the morphology, the photo of the cells, we can see the schematic of the cells that comes from the book of Soledad Bessner, my teacher in morphology. And after that, we use flow cytometry, we use morphology, cytogenetic, cytochemistry, etc. More B, lymphoproliferative disorders, chronic. T, chronic lymphoproliferative disorders that we can recognize very easily. Acute myeloid leukemia, different types. B, acute lymphoblastic leukemia. T, acute lymphoblastic leukemia. And with that, we were happy till now. In 2016, the WHO published the consensus classification of hematology malignancies, and really that changed everything. And now it's beginning to be applied in many of the hospitals, and not everybody can apply this technology to classify the hematology disorders. Today we know that the acute lymphoblastic leukemia, lymphoma, it's a molecular and genetic classification of these disorders. And really, that is what is relevant today. And for that, we need to do kits like that, a multiplex next generation sequencing kit, in that we can see the positivity or not for these genes, in that with that we will define the therapy, the clinical trial, the diagnostic and the prognostic of acute lymphoblastic leukemia. Here, the acute myeloid leukemia, we see the actual classification, nothing similar than the previous one, that was M0, M2, M1, M2, M3. And the same, after we suspect an acute myeloid leukemia today, we have to do something like that, next generation sequencing, in that we can check the genes, and with that, to do the therapy diagnostic prognostic. MDS, same, we can suspect, and we are going to talk about that, how to suspect MDS from the routine hematology analyzer, and after, in the future, you will only have to do a kit, a next generation sequencing kit, to see the type of therapy and what you have to do in the prognostic. Same for multiple myeloma, and same for non-Hodgkin lymphoma and lymphoproliferative disorders. What is the contribution of flow cytometry in the hematology diagnosis in the next decades? I think will not be the same that now. The flow cytometry has lost some of the roles, like counting blasts, that now is not anymore permitted for the WHO classification. You need to count it in the using a microscope, not anymore with flow, because there are many different type of blasts with very different positivities for different markers, and will be something for screening, for me, in my opinion. Sorry for the experts in flow cytometry that don't blame me, but this is what I see. I am pragmatic. Here we can see four types of diseases from the lymphoid origin. One is normal, that is the top left, is shown quite clear, using CD45 cytoscatter. And here we are using only three monoclonals, CD45, a T marker, CD2, and a B marker, CD19. And using these three markers, only three, we can classify quite well, and we can do a screening quite well of the lymphocyte abnormalities. In the first one is a normal one. Second, that is in the top right of the slide, we can see an acute lymphoblastic leukemia. B cells are marked in dark blue, and we can see that there are two populations with different intensity for CD45. The blasts that are CD45 dim, not negative, but dim, very low positive, and the normal B cells that are positive for CD19 and are normal. The T cells are in light blue, and here the neutrophils are not relevant. In the bottom left, here we can see a chronic lymphoproliferative disorder. You can see that the positivity for CD45 is lower, not dim, but a little lower than normal, and that is different than acute lymphoblastic leukemia, that you can compare to B lymphoproliferative proliferations, but one is acute and the other is chronic. And the fourth one in the bottom right of the slide is a viral infection with an increase of T cells with normal CD45 intensity. Here we can see the diagnosis, a normal B-ALL, chronic lymphocytic leukemia, and infectious mononucleosis. Next generation sequencing, according to the WHO, there is a chapter in the WHO that says that not using this technology, there were many cytogenetic abnormalities that were not found with the classical techniques, and we need to do that today. If we don't do it, we can even do malpraxis, because today is not anymore, for example, possible to say only chronic lymphocytic leukemia, that's all. No, you have to say if it's a chronic lymphocytic leukemia, with the election of 13, that is good prognosis, or the election of the 11 or 17, that is bad prognosis. You cannot any, or a trisomy of the chromosome 12. You cannot do any more diagnosis of CLL without that, because the treatment is different, the prognosis is absolutely different. How I see the future diagnosis of the hematology malignancies, I think, of course, we will need the hematology instruments. They are going to do a screening, and after that, we will decide to do a blood smear or not, and after the blood smear and some clinical features, we are going to decide to do next generation sequencing if we suspect a malignancy. But also we have to do qPCR, quantitative PCR, as we have seen now, for infectious diseases. That will be much more accurate, will be for sure the diagnosis, and will be the standard one for diagnosis of the hematological disorders. Of course, from the instruments, we will appreciate to have good flagging. Now it's quite a specific flagging, but I would like to have much more specific flagging, even maybe suspect high-risk leukemia or suspect chronic lymphoproliferative disorders. I think we need to try to reproduce what WHO is asking. Maybe only multiple myeloma or plasma cell leukemia, only acute lymphoblastic leukemia, acute myeloid leukemia, only the non-Hodgkin lymphoma. I think we need to try to reproduce the classification that will need further analysis with molecular next-generation sequencing kits. This is an example, an acute lymphoblastic leukemia. Here in the DIF, we can see that the blasts are in the bottom of the plot, normal cells with correspondent flags, and after we see the morphology and we count the cells. In the future will not be relevant. I think we will only see the morphology, not counting even the cells, because for that will not be relevant. But flow cytometry can do it very well, only counting the approximately the number of abnormal cells. And the myeloid leukemia, as you can see, is different. The blasts are in different position, and that is what I am going to talk, position of the cells. The position will define many characteristics of the cells. And again, we will have the blood smear that we are going to confirm the diagnosis, and we can count or not. I am not against that. We will not have a lot of leukemias to count every day, but will be not really relevant for the treatment and prognosis. And here we have a slide in that we can see the lymphocyte morphology with different type of cells. We cannot do a flag only for all these cells, saying variant lymphs. I think we need to try, even if we don't report that, even if we give a number only, but I think we need to try to create flagging for each of the abnormal cells. After what we can do with this information, once we have the flagging, we have to use several technologies we are going to discuss at the end of my presentation. We can use, for example, the validation decision rules that we can see here. I participated in this group creating that. And as you can see here, we have optimizing the best these rules. We have about 3% of false negatives. Is that good? Is that bad? I think when the people is asking me, is 3% enough? I say, okay, how many cases you have per day? 500. 500 is 15 cases every day that you are missing. Is that good for you? How we can avoid that? How we can improve the detection of disorders not having a lot of false positive? I think the answer is cell population data. Here is the list of participants in that you can see myself. cell population data. That is my topic, and that is what I think is necessary to include and to calibrate and to control and to use it much more in hematology. We have here the mean rate, values, normal values for one instrument of cell population data, neutrophil X, that is the complexity, the scatter, neutrophil Y, that is fluorescence, neutrophil Z, that is the size of the cells. As we can have all these parameters, and including we can have the standard deviation that is not included here, that is the anisocytosis of these parameters. And with that, we can have this, the, all this information from all these cells and to try to classify them. With that, this is an example from Dr. Woro et al., published in 2018, in that we can see an approach of different situations, disorders with the different values of cell population data. You can see is in red, the high values, is in white, is the normal values, is low values in light blue, and both light blue, it's the very low values. And you can see that the pattern is different from the majority of the lymphoproliferative disorders, acute lymphoblastic leukemias, acute myeloid leukemias, septic shock, viral infections, etc. The pattern is different. Only we need to use the right tool to classify these different disorders. For example, using neutrophil mean fluorescence. This parameter is measuring the we can see here represented in the graph, the neutrophil fluorescence, the mean fluorescence, and that has been published to be useful for sepsis, for infection management, including differentiation of bacterial versus viral infections. Some studies show as good performance as procalcitonin and better performance than CRP, detecting sepsis, for example. And there are many studies about using fluorescence, neutrophil fluorescence, for in different situations, majority infections. These are the reference values for the MineRay instruments. Monocyte Z. Monocyte Z is the monocyte volume. I will discuss that in my COVID-19 hematology analysis talk during this CUBE 2020. But here we can see that the representation is the other angle of the CUBE, that is the size. The size of the monocytes, it's important for example, megaloblastic anemia. I have a patent and articles about that. In folate deficiency, for anemia, is also important, the monocyte size, because in macrocytic anemias, monocyte and neutrophils are also big. And we can use neutrophil and monocyte macrocytosis for the diagnosis of these disorders. Also, in the detection of COVID, we will see that monocyte set can predict the severe critical phase of the disease. Here another study that also helped use the monocyte Z and compare it with C-reactive protein for bacterial infections from Mardi et al., published in 2009. The reference values for monocyte forward scatter, monocyte Z, we can see here, and we can see here an example of a normal monocyte and a big monocyte, monocyte macrocytosis that we can see in a case of COVID-19 that we will see in the presentation of COVID-19. The neutrophil Z is the neutrophil size, and as I said, it's helping to detect megaloblastic anemia. Moreover, in addition, when in addition is iron deficiency, because in these cases the MCB can be normal and can be both B12 deficiency and iron deficiency, and many of the cases of B12 are not pure, are combined, and in this case the MCB is normal, but neutrophil Z and monocyte Z are high. And also can use is used a lot, the neutrophil size for diagnosis of sepsis, as we can see in these articles that we can see here. Neutrophil size is important for sepsis. Here we can see the reference values of neutrophil size. Here we can see a normal neutrophils in the bottom right, a big neutrophil and a big neutrophil hypersegmented, that the size will be similar, but we will have to see the neutrophil X to combine both to identify and to differentiate between big and hypersegmented and big and not hypersegmented. And here you can see the reference values for the MineRay instruments. Monocyte ZSD, monocyte anisocytosis, I discovered that in the first article published in any time for CELPD, I published myself the patent to detecting malaria. Monocyte anisocytosis is very important detecting for screening of malaria. It's also important detecting dengue. There are 3 articles about that. It's a predictor of sepsis and differentiate also reactive thrombocytosis from essential thrombocytemia. Of course, this is all research, not approved by FDA, but this is important. And here we can see a lot of articles about monocyte standard deviation, monocyte anisocytosis. The reference values for the monocyte anisocytosis, we can see here these reference values. Lymphocyte size has been very useful too. Lymphocyte standard deviation for lymphoproliferative disorders is CLL. We can see the small size of lymphocytes that can be used for the diagnosis of or suspect diagnosis of CLL and other lymphoproliferative disorders. And according to the size, the scatter, and the fluorescence, we can, I think, suspect with high probability that is a reactive or malignant disorder. And just using B marker, because any B increase of B cells is malignant. There are only one polyclonal lymphocytosis of the smoking women that is normal, but any increase of absolute number of B cells is malignant. Only with a B marker and cell population data, we can do a quite good screening of chronic and acute lymphoproliferative disorders. CD45 intensity will be also very helpful. And here the references talking about that. There are many others. I only mentioned some of them. And the reference values for lymphocyte size. Neutrophilics, it's another important parameter, is the neutrophil complexity. It correlates with the neutrophil granularity. And we can see here 3 articles about that, how it's correlated, neutrophil X, and how it can be used for the screening of myelodysplasia. We did another study in Hamburg, in Germany, to see in the routine, applying a different thing, not only classifying MDS, just apply neutrophil X in the routine. And we have seen that 10% of the patients that have received chemotherapy have neutrophil degranulation. Not all of them get MDS, but some of them in during the next years will develop MDS. For this reason, neutrophil X can be maybe a prediction, we have to explore that, a prediction factor of neutrophil myelodysplasia. But initially, we can see the granulation in 10% of the patients with chemotherapy that have received chemotherapy, not all of them will develop myelodysplasia. And here you can see the web picture in that we can see a degranulated neutrophil, a normal neutrophil, and the reference values for main ray neutrophil X, that is neutrophil complexity. And after that, for sure, the plan, when you suspect an MDS, maybe also with cytopenias and other of the evolution of the cytopenias that will be for several months, we can do immediately the kit for that. That is science fiction now, but I think we need to explore these possibilities to, of course, when this test will be much more available for everybody. But that will be for me the future. When you suspect MDS, you will do this kit to screen for the possibility that you have a genetic abnormality, together with cytopenias, for sure. And again, here we have the values of CELPD, a lot of parameters. We have the possible application of classification of disorders. We have flow. And the question is how we combine all this information. Qualitative morphology, I don't think will be quantitative, flow, cell population data, I think, and after to decide or not to do next generation sequencing. I think how we can improve the information provided by the instrumentation, I think we need to use expert systems, artificial intelligence. Maybe some of you don't know, but I am a lecturer in the University of Lugano, South Switzerland, about artificial intelligence. And I'm working with artificial intelligence and expert system from the 1989. There are three types of expert systems. Rules-based, for example, the ICSH validation rules for hematology that try to reproduce an expert. This job was done before that by a doctor that was validating the hematology results. Now it's an expert system that do that. So we have to be familiar because we, all of us, use expert systems, for example, also for chromatography, to see the peak of gas chromatography in compared with when we have an intoxication, to see which poison have caused the problem to the patient. And we compare the peak with a database. This is, again, an expert system. Neural networks is another method that we can use. All the digital imaging, automated digital imaging used in the world is made with neural networks. The recognition of a plate in a parking is also made with neural networks. And Bayesian network-based in Bayes' theorem. Bayesian analysis, for me, it's really the one we have to use together with the rules-based and neural networks. The rules-based, there are rules and meta-rules. Why we use meta-rules? Because when there are many rules, for example, many rules about thrombopenia, we have to make a meta-rule that says, is thrombopenia yes or not? If it's not thrombopenia, we don't have to pass all the rules about thrombopenia. We eliminate them. But the reason, when you have a lot of rules, you use meta-rules to focus in the topic. The thing is, intuition may seem like a human trick, but machines can be pretty good at it too. Underlying a hunch are dozens of tiny subconscious rules through we have learned from experience. That process was made for the ICSH rules. We were trying to reproduce what the humans we do, and we have several meetings, some meeting, myself, Professor Zini, etc., in that we agreed what will be the consensus rules for hematology. We agreed, we double-check that, we make evidence-based medicine, and after that we publish the rules, and many people are using these rules in the world. Example of rules-based ISTAT, the international consensus, that many people is using it. Neural networks. Neural networks looks like very sophisticated, but are not. I have the opportunity to use neural networks in the beginning of digital imaging when the Micro 21, you have to do to train the instrument yourself, and you have to choose your slides to identify them and to make the system learn from you. The system will be as good as you are, and that is important. A neural network will be as good as the expert that says that finally this was that. If you have wrong diagnosis, the neural network will reproduce the errors eternally. If you say this is a band and it's not a band, the instrument will do it as you are doing. That is something that we need to know. The neural networks are as good as the experts that do that create the neural networks. That was clear in the Micro 21 when you were training yourself the instrument with your own slides. Neural networks are very sophisticated modeling techniques capable of modeling extremely complex functions. Linear modeling commonly uses the technique of to optimize strategies. That is complicated. Let me explain you in a different way. Neural networks are very useful when the subject to predict can only be one thing. For example, neutrophil in a blood smear. For example, automated digital imaging or a car plate entering or exiting of a parking, but cannot be used when a patient have two or more diseases at the same time. How the neural network can classify two or three or four diseases at the same time? It's practically impossible. You will need to do another method for that. And that is neural networks learned by example. The neural networks use gather representative data and then invoke training algorithms to automatically learn the structure of the data. An example, put in a box snails, apples, bananas, and peanuts, and the system can classify them. For example, here I put a corn, a clock, and a button, and put that in a box that analyze several detectors, analyze size, color, weight, and can classify quite accurately the three different objects that you put in this box. The size, the color, the weight permits to classify these things. But the thing is, these things can be only one, but a disease is not the same. A patient can have fever because have tuberculosis, can have anemia because have an iron deficiency, and can have a colon cancer and all together can look like a disease, but it's not. There are three diseases at the same time. Neural networks, as I said, are as good as the database you use to train the system. And you cannot miss any diagnosis. If you don't have Ebola in your database, will never make a diagnosis of Ebola. And so you need to be sure that you include all the rare diseases, including congenital dyserythropoiesis, etc., etc., that are rare diseases. Pyropoikilocytosis, that is very rare form of homozygous elliptocytosis. If you don't have it, you will never diagnose that. And that we need to consider that. But are very useful when you have an univoc possibility, like is this a neutrophil? Yes or not. Is this a monocyte? Yes or not. For that are very good. Don't consider when you use it in a patient because the patient can have more than one disease. Bayesian analysis is my preferred together with the rules. And it's interesting, the Bayesian analysis were discovered by Thomas Bayes in the 16th century. He said something very, very interesting. He was surprised and he said, the more frequent is the more probable. And that is what he said. I explained that very simply to the people, to my alumnus, to the students in the University of Lugano. Imagine I am a doctor and my nurse told me, Dr. Simon, you have a patient. And immediately I will think to myself, what can be? Okay, I can make a guess. Just analyzing my database of patients. If the patient, I don't know if he's male, female, old, young, I can guess that maybe have 23% to be a chronic lymphocytic leukemia. Why? Because 23% of my patients have CLL, because my consultation is hematology. And with the same rule, I know now that the person is a lady that is 65 years old. Okay, in this group of age, CLL is not 23, it's 42% of probable. Only knowing the age and the gender, I can guess how frequent is the probability to be CLL. Of course, if you have lymphocytosis, now only with lymphocytosis, only with one parameter, I can guess in my database of patients, only with lymphocytosis will be 73% of probabilities to have a CLL, only with one parameter, lymphocytosis. And the thing is, that is amazing, but that is the only method suggested by Harrison Principles of Internal Medicine, the book of medicine we all of us practically have used to learn medicine, is the only one recommended. Because it's not a black box, you can always trigger where it comes from, the relationship between a symptom and a disease. And for example, a Bayesian analysis will work like that. When you have fever, neutrophilia, headache, vomiting, photophobia, skin rash, you have 90% probabilities to have a bacterial meningitis and 10% of other disorders, alone or combined. And that is how it works. It just calculates the probability based on the facts you have. You have more facts, better. You have cell population data, better. You have morphology, better. You have flow, better. But always will give you a probability of the different possibilities of the disorders. And that's all. I hope that this presentation will be useful for you. I am sorry for the noises because the Wi-Fi was not possible to do it in my normal place, but I hope that everybody understood and was useful for you this presentation. Thank you very much.
So thank you, Ramon, for such an enlightening lecture. You have always been a good friend for many years, and it's always something new to learn from you every time we hear you. And now moving on to the third session of Q 2020, which is headed by Dr. Anil Handu. And sir, it's a great honor to introduce the chairperson of a session which is headed by such a humble human being who is such a learned person also. Our first chairperson for the session is Dr. Anita Suryanarayan. Ma'am is Vice President Quality Assurance, South Listomastopolis. She is postgraduate in pathology from University of Bombay and practicing pathology since past 30 years. Has a vast experience in blood banking and has headed the LTMFC Sion Medical College Blood Bank at Mumbai. Travels to Chennai from Mumbai with an opportunity again in blood banking as a blood bank officer and then pathologist at Lister, currently designated as Vice President Quality Assurance in Lister Metropolis. And it's always been a good learning experience whenever I interact with ma'am over past many, many years. She's such an energetic and, inspiring woman, and it's always good to learn. So thanks, ma'am, for chairing this session, and thank you again. Also, the second chairperson for this session is Dr. Sujay Prasad, and sir needs no introduction. Every one of you knows sir. Sir is our director at Anand Laboratories, Bangalore, a Newberg associate. Sir's area of expertise is data science and automation, artificial intelligence and allied applications, induced flow cytometry, tandem mass spectrometry, process and workflow optimization. So whenever we meet Dr. Sujay Prasad, it's always new to learn about the artificial intelligence, information and technology, how it can be integrated with the system, how it can be integrated with LIS. Sir was the first, I think he started with, scanning of the prescriptions and attaching with the reports and going live with that, and always been a pioneer when it comes to the technology. So thank you again to Dr. Sujay and Dr. Anita for chairing this session. And I request you to take this proceeding further. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. It's a wonderful time to be here with you today on this Sunday after a great session which was held yesterday. And we look forward for today's session also. I also want to thank Mindray, who have done a great thing in keeping 2 days of a very interesting session, which is so different from all the COVID webinars and all that we have been going through. A refreshing change, a good change, and a change for the better, because this is going into details of a subject which for us, we have the experts on our panel, of course, but for us, many of us, it has been something which we have really looked at with an eye and not known that there is so much to pick up from sheet paper which comes up from these automated instruments, which are able to give us so much of information, which down the line is probably going to help us in deciphering more. For myself, I have been an operations head for many years, almost 30 odd years, and then took a leap this side to change the path a bit and enter into quality assurance. And let me tell you, there is no better assurance that we can give when we get a team who's supporting us on the latest technology, the latest equipments, and the latest know-how and conferences such as this, which help us in making decisions, which help us in treating patients, which help us in knowing what to do, when to do, and how to guide the clinicians. So thank you, and we can get on with the conference. It is my pleasure to introduce the session head, Dr. Anil Handu, who is a director and senior consultant of laboratory services, Dr. B.L. Kapoor Hospital, New Delhi. Dr. Handu is a MD pathology and has a fellowship in hematological medicine from London and a fellowship from flow cytometry from Australia. His areas of expertise are hematopathology, flow cytometry, hematological disorders, coagulation, and cytomorphometry. He is an expert for various national and international committees for hematology and flow cytometry, and he's involved in industry and academic institutions. He is technical assessor for NABL in the fields of hematology, molecular hematology, and flow cytometry. Dr. Sangamitra Mukherjee, she is a consultant pathologist in AMRI Hospital, Kolkata. Of course, she'll be talking on Eastern Platelet Syndrome, what's normal. Dr. Sangamitra is a practicing pathologist for the last 15 years and is with AMRI Hospital, Salt Lake for the last 12 years. She has over 6 publications in pathology in national and international journal. She is also a technical assessor for NABL in hematology and histology. Dr. Aditi Mittal, Senior Registrar, B.L. Kapoor Super Speciality Hospital, has completed her Master's MD in Pathology from Sri Ram Murthy Medical College, Bareilly in September 2016. She has publications in Indian journals and is also a member of Delhi Society of Hematology. She is currently doing supervised specialized reporting in hematology at B.L. Kapoor Super Speciality Hospital.
Good morning and welcome to this session, a very important session on platelets. My name is Dr. Sujay Prasad, and I'm a pathologist since 1995. My interests are basically in IT and laboratory medicine, Of course, hematology is very close to my heart. I'm looking forward to this session because it's all about platelets, and I look forward to learning from all the eminent speakers here. Let's look forward to this session. Good morning once again, and it is my pleasure to introduce to you Dr. Shehnaaz Kodaiji. Of course, she doesn't need any introduction because she's such an eminent person within India as well as abroad. Dr. Kodaiji has over 34 years of post-MD experience in the field of laboratory hematology. She has received extensive training abroad and in India in diagnostic hematopathology and ancillary laboratory assays. Her special areas of interest are benign hematology, hemato-oncology, and flow cytometry. She has been bestowed with awards on several national and international occasions. She has published numerous book chapters and articles in both international and national journals. It is a privilege to have known her and continue to learn a lot from her teachings. It is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Amrita Saraf, Senior Consultant Hematologist at Sir Gangaram Hospital, New Delhi. Dr. Amrita has a vast experience in hematology, working at different at the Department of Hematology, Sir Gangaram Hospital, as consultant and senior consultant hematologist since 2007. Her areas of interest are hemoglobinopathies using HPLC and hemoglobin electrophoresis, hematopoietic malignancies including bone marrows, and flow cytometric immunophenotyping are her other special areas. She has been a member of Indian Association of Pathologists and Microbiologists, Delhi Society of Hematology, Cytometry Society, and Indian Association of Hematology and Transfusion Medicine. It will be a pleasure to hear Dr. Amrita Saraf speak today. Dr. Dharmendra Rathod, pathologist and quality manager at Dr. Bhatt Pathology Laboratory, Rajkot, Gujarat. And he would be talking on platelet reflex testing streamlining workflow. And it's quite a challenge. All of us know in our laboratories how the workflow can get affected when reflex testing has to be done for low platelets. Dr. Rathod has over 14 years of experience in the field of hematopathology and histopathology. He has undergone vigorous training in quality and is an expert in quality techniques. He has presented multiple papers and research articles in various national journals. His areas of interest are immunofluorescence testing in autoimmune disease. I really look forward to hearing Dr. Dharmendra Rathod talk on this reflex testing workflow. Thank you. Once again, it's a pleasure to introduce Dr. Naveen Kakkar. He needs no introduction. He's professor in the Department of Pathology, Christian Medical College and Hospital at Ludhiana. And he is currently working as in charge hematopathology at CMC Ludhiana. He has done his MBBS and MD from CMC and College and Hospital Ludhiana. His areas of interest are automated analyzers, spurious automated results, hemoglobinopathy, coagulation disorders, and leukemias. It will be a pleasure to hear him speak. Thank you.
Hello. So thanks, Dr. Ramon Simon Lopez, for his insightful lecture on usefulness of CPT parameters in data analysis. And as we know that many of the parameters are underutilized, so CPT parameters are yet to be explored. So thanks, Dr. Ramon Simon Lopez, for his lecture. Now I welcome Dr. Anil Handu for his lecture on platelet disorders.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Dr. Anil Handu. I work as a senior director in BLK Super Speciality Hospital in Delhi. As a part of my portfolio, I also look after Nanavati Hospitals in Mumbai. We have a lab in both the places. I'm a hematologist by profession. I've been in the industry for almost now 18 to 20 years. And my personal interests are very specifically with respect to hematology analyzers, as well as flow cytometry. Thank you. My topic for the day is cytomorphometry in platelet disorders, and I'm sure by now a lot of people would have told you about what is meant by cytomorphometry. The idea of cytomorphometry comes from somebody who is very close to me and a mentor and a friend, Professor Nair, who used the terms hemocytomorphometry talking about hematology and cytomorphometry. So as the word tells you, cyto means a cell, morpho means morphology, and metry means measurement. And we are trying to do this part of it in platelet disorders this morning. This is the place where I work, BLK Super Speciality Hospital in New Delhi, and bring you warm regards from here, from the entire department. And I'm sure hopefully in next 10 to 15 minutes, I should be able to give you an overview or a preview of what platelet disorders are all about and how hematology analyzers are contributing to their diagnosis and eventually helping the patients in their treatment. Now, this is a question which I would have preferred to ask all of you in person. Unfortunately, these are Corona times and I can't do that. But these three people on your screen, and I'm sure all of you know them very well. So what's common in all of them? And I'm also showing you another very interesting picture over here, which you can see. And this picture is that of the platelets here. So what do you think would be common in these three personalities and the platelets? So if I tell you what is common, it is nothing but controversy. They're forever controversial. Something or the other keeps happening, and every time they come up with something and it becomes a big news. And platelets are not far behind. If we remember dengue times, platelet becomes the most controversial thing a lab can generate, a report a lab can generate. Anyway, I will not get into controversies. I will just take you to what is the physiology and platelet development. How did the platelet come about development of its own self? So we know that the platelets actually will develop in the bone marrow from the precursor cell, which is a megakaryocyte. And eventually the megakaryocyte will be against a sinusoid, from where the proplatelets will come. And from these proplatelets, these platelets will be actually generated, which are nothing but complete platelet particles. So the most immature cell in the platelet development would be a proplatelet, as is obvious in this pictorial presentation. Now, platelets have a very, very interesting role to play. You know, if you look at it, they not only have a role to play in hemostasis, which we all know, they are also important because there are a lot of inflammatory markers which are present within the platelets. And all of you would know that platelets somehow are also increased as a part of the inflammatory process in the body. So if you look at this picture, you have this megakaryocyte, which is the parent of the platelets. And this parent of the platelet is eventually giving you these small little droplets which get into the sinusoid. And mind you, in all these platelets, you have a lot of these granules, which are the alpha, the gamma, and the delta granules, etc., which have all these markers within them and all these hormones within them and substances within them which are important for inflammation, and also they are important for ensuring the hemostasis. Now, why is there such a hullabaloo about platelet? Why are we even talking about it? I am a person who strongly believes avoid transfusions in general. And the reason for avoiding transfusion is that you are taking a blood product which potentially has an effect to your body in many different ways. So if I look at platelets as a transfusion therapy, you can develop antibodies, which can be anti-HLA antibodies. There may be even platelet-specific antibodies causing refractoriness. You can get transfusion-transmitted infections. You can get allergic reactions. You can even get issues which can potentially be fatal, like trally, etc. So I'll not get into details of that. Why I want to show you the slide is only for one reason, that it is not only that the transfusion can be taken and the platelet part of it will be taken care of. And this is something which happens so often in dengue, and that's why platelets are not something which should be just taken on the shelf. Now let's look at platelet disorders, because that's why what my topic is. Platelet disorders can primarily be classified into two major groups, one which is congenital, the other one which is acquired, and within them you can have quantitative defects wherein they can be reduced, which is what is otherwise called thrombocytopenia, and they can be increased wherein it's called thrombocytosis. And of course you can have qualitative defects in the platelets which actually will not really affect the number or may affect the number at the same time and give rise to defective functioning of the platelets. And despite having good numbers, the platelet function may not be appropriate. So when you look at all this information, it is not only the quantitation which is important for the platelets, it's also the quality of the platelets which becomes equally important at some point of time. So if we look at quantitative effects, defects of the platelet function, the most important one which everybody gets bothered about is thrombocytopenia. And at some point of time, we are all affected by this because somewhere or the other, whenever there is an infection, initially there might be thrombocytosis. However, you subsequently might get thrombocytopenia, and which can be very, very severe as well. So the quantitative defects in platelet could be because of decreased marrow production. For example, in aplasia, you can have increased splenic sequestration where they're getting distorted, disordered, for instance, in hypersplenism, for instance, in CML, etc. And you can also have accelerated destruction, for example, in ITP. The most common one that we see is ITP. Now, if you look at platelet in terms of numbers, you have to blame this man for giving us the information about platelet counting. I'm not sure how many of you know this. This guy is an Italian pathologist, Giulio Bizzero, who actually was the first person to tell us how to count the platelets. And he was the first person to describe the platelets as distinct corpuscles. And in fact, he was the man who was first to tell us that they have a significant role to play in coagulation and thrombosis. And by now, we already know that when you look at platelet as a cell, the entire coagulation cascade is so very much dependent upon the platelet. Now, when you look at platelet enumeration, we are always interested in numbers. We are always wanting to know how many platelets are there in the patient's blood. Now, what are the various methodologies which one uses for this? Of course, is the hemocytometry, where you're using a Nuba's chamber and stuff like that, and doing microscopic evaluation of that and getting to know how many platelets do you have. You can also have indirect methods where you count one cell, for instance, the red cell, and in proportion to that, you try and see how many platelets are there, and then there are formulae, etc., to know the platelet counting part of it. Now, the moment you sit down and try to count, obviously it's going to be cumbersome. When you have so many samples to count platelets, it obviously becomes a bit of a challenge. So therefore, there has been a quest for many, many years for people to actually develop methodologies which will help you to count the platelets. And the first methodology which was adopted was done on a platelet-rich plasma. Eventually, whole blood was used on a fully automated methodology, and I'm sure a lot of us are already aware of it because this happens day, night, right, left, and center in all our practices, in all our laboratories. So as far as the counting of platelets is concerned, what is the international reference method ICSH standard method for counting of platelets? The ICSH standard method for platelet counting till 1988 was the manual phase contrast microscopy. And for this, you needed to have a chamber, a Nuba's chamber. You needed to have a phase contrast microscope. And then basis that, you would also use the platelet fluid, diluting fluid, and subsequently on the chamber, you would count the platelets and eventually come out with a platelet count. Again, this was a manual counting, and this was the only way the counting could have been done. Mind you, when you had this kind of a reference, the variability in this count could be as high as 30%. So in 2001, the entire process of counting the platelets changed to a reference method from where we were to the counting on flow cytometric platelet counting. And interestingly, the RBC and the platelet ratio was used as a standard methodology of platelet counting, and that is what is available even till date. So this is a typical flow cytometric plot wherein you have these platelet and RBC coincidences which you do not count. You take platelets against a total count of RBCs, and then basis that, you are able to give the ICSH standard counting of platelets using flow cytometric methodology. Now we have counted the platelets. We know that preferable methodology is flow cytometry, and a lot of analyzers using flow cytometry for counting of platelets. Of course, immunoplatelet counting would have been preferred, but that would be very expensive and would take time as well. Important aspect is a lot of people don't even consider, other than the count from the platelet, parameters which are also available from hematology analyzers valuable. And it's unfortunate. The reason is that most of us do not pay attention to the information coming out from the hematology analyzer. One of the very interesting parameters is mean platelet volume. A lot of people would have probably just foo-fooed it, kept it one side and said MPV is not a great parameter. But there are enough studies available wherein it is informed to all of us that when you have increased mean platelet volume, a lot of disease states are associated with it. And not only are the disease states associated with it, you can also have prognostication in them. For example, if you look at the cardiac diseases, like in the first reference that I have quoted here, you can have a higher mean platelet volume, and this can really relate to a higher cardiac incidence as well. You have also seen a higher mortality in patients if they have increased mean platelet volume. Also, the mean platelet volume becomes important when you are trying to figure out whether this is a dysplastic change or not. So mean platelet volume, increased mean platelet volume in various diseases becomes important for all of us. So if there is something increased, sometimes even the decreased one can be very, very important. So remember, mean platelet volume reduction has been attributed to a lots and lots of information on the internet if you go across and try to figure it out. But the most striking one, which I thought would be important, would be to remember that mean platelet volume is an important risk factor for all the diseases like arterial thrombosis, myocardial infarction, diabetes, and venous thromboembolism. And this particular disease, somehow the mean platelet volume becomes one of the most important characteristics to predict this disease. And I'm sure by now you would have all guessed it. You have this eczematous rash, you have the platelets which are so small, and of course the rash on the back of this baby. And this is a case of WAS, which is otherwise called the Wiskott-Aldrich syndrome. And when you look at this particular disease, how would you have been able to get the mean platelet volume unless you would have had a thankful possibility of working it on a hematology analyzer? So in addition to this, there is a whole big role of mean platelet volume in dengue. For all the people who do not have the immature platelet fraction with them, mean platelet volume can still be an important parameter and can help. This is one of the papers which wherein this algorithm has been adopted. And they've looked at the mean platelet volume. The moment you have a low mean platelet volume with a low platelet count, there is a hemorrhagic tendency which they have observed, and obviously the need for transfusions. On the other hand, if you have a high mean platelet volume with stable platelet counts, it generally indicates recovery of the disease. Whereas if you have high mean platelet volume with falling platelets, it indicates active disease and might need platelet transfusions. So keeping this in mind, mean platelet volume itself becomes an important parameter which comes from a hematology analyzer and actually helps you to really treat patients with disease. You also need to remember one very important thing, that this mean platelet volume is influenced by a lot of factors, and therefore all this needs to be kept in mind. There can be genetic variations, it can be affected by age with a higher value as you advance in your age. Gender, it's generally seen that males have a higher mean platelet volume, the race, ethnicity, hormonal profiles, etc., etc. So all of these stuff will actually influence people to get the mean platelet volume at various levels. So therefore, all I'm trying to say is that mean platelet volume, when looked at, needs to be age specific, and you need to develop your own parameters with respect to its reference intervals. Now, the next interesting parameter, which is from the platelets, is the immature platelet fraction. And mind you guys, this particular immature platelet fraction per se is something which people have exploited a lot for giving information, and it's been very, very useful. However, I don't know how many of you would have heard him, but Professor Nair says there is nothing immature about IPF. And I don't disagree with him, because the moment he says that, it just comes to my mind and says, it's elementary, my dear Watson. What is so elementary about it? The proplatelet, which is the so-called immature platelet, does not actually come out into the blood. And therefore, there is nothing immature about it. Anyway, I will not get into the controversy or the support of immature platelet fraction per se, but what needs to remember is that this immature platelet fraction is an important parameter, because it helps you to pick up certain information. This is an example of a patient from East India where the optical platelets or the fluorescent platelets were done, and the fluorescent platelets were obviously much higher than what you got from the impedance platelet. And in them, if you look at the immature platelet fraction, it becomes important for us because you need to realize that the IPF in this particular state will be higher. So therefore, again, one needs to be clear what population are you serving and have you defined your reference intervals. Now, when this IPF came about, this was one slide which my friend Dr. Kunal Sehgal showed in one of his presentations. Neighbors envy owner's pride. And I just cannot leave this slide out of my mind because it truly was at that point of time. We did not have the immature platelet fraction available in our laboratory. And it was surely an envious thought in my mind when everybody else would give an IPF, we could not. Eventually, we got this MindRay 6800 and we were also able to do this IPF. And thus, a lot of other people started envying us as well. So when you look at this immature platelet fraction, what does it tell you? This immature platelet fraction is a fraction of platelets which has got a higher fluorescence. As you can see, this area shows the fluorescence and this axis shows the size. So they are bigger in size slightly, and they of course have a higher fluorescence because they have higher genetic material within it. And this immature fraction of the platelets is akin to what you get as a reticulocyte count. So if you look at immature platelet fraction, its increase will suggest that the marrow is active, and if it's decreased, it will suggest that the marrow is depressed. And in fact, in one of the presentations which my colleague Dr. Aditi would have done, she would have shown you that IPF is one of the first indicators of bone marrow regeneration. So therefore, IPF suddenly becomes an important parameter to be kept in mind. Now, this is how you look at the IPF. You need to define ranges for IPF, and for just like any other parameter that you have in a hematology analyzer. In our laboratory, we have derived a range of 0.6 to 8%, and basis that we are able to figure out what we're dealing with. This is one of the slides which my friend Dr. Dadu, who is my colleague as well, has given me, where she has shown in a patient of dengue how IPF would become important. And in fact, she eventually published this data. And I'll just show you, this was eventually published in the journal called International Journal of Laboratory Hematology in 2013. And this was, in fact, the first article from our country to talk about IPF. Now, this is what was the gist of the article, just to show you how it works out. If you see this, you monitor the patient's platelets and you also monitor the patient's immature platelet fraction parallelly. And as you see, as the platelets fall down, the IPF keeps going up, and the moment the IPF stabilizes, the platelets are due to come back. And that's what actually eventually gives you the information. Of course, Dr. Dadu and her team had said that there is a upper limit of 10%. Whenever you have 10% IPF, the platelets are due to recover in dengue, which eventually was proven in subsequent studies that that may not really be so. And instead, a stability of the IPF is what would be important. And that would, in fact, give information to ensure that you're dealing with a dengue kind of infection, which is going to recover the very next day. So remember, IPF in dengue is a potential tool for predicting recovery in patients having thrombocytopenia. And as I mentioned already, this 10% does not hold validity anymore. Another interesting parameter is platelet to large cell ratio, which a lot of people would like to talk about nowadays. And just to give you an information, anything which is beyond 12 femtoliters under this area, under the curve, is what is called the platelet to large cell ratio. And in fact, it's been very interesting. There are just numerous studies on platelet to large cell ratio. There are some which are ongoing, especially in patients with dengue, etc., where we're trying to see, does this platelet to large cell ratio give us any specific information? Interestingly, when you look at the MPV and platelet to large cell ratio indices, it's been very strongly associated with the coronary artery disease. So platelet to large cell ratio is an important parameter which one can look at. And again, this is something which is coming from almost all the analyzers today. There is also one very interesting parameter which people are now talking about, and that is, which is called the composite platelet index. The composite platelet index is actually a conceptual index. You know, it's derived when you multiply the platelet count in decimals. You know, you're not supposed to take 150,000 as platelet, but instead you're going to take 1.5 and you're going to multiply it with the mean platelet volume. And the moment you get it beyond 1.5, you know that your patient is not really going to have a problem. Whereas the moment it's going to be less than 1.5, that means that a significant thrombocytopenia and the mean platelet volume is going up. So this is a very interesting index again, which people are working on nowadays. And again, a lot of information which comes to your table because of this, because you're able to figure out how much is the mean platelet volume in such cases. Just to give you an overall, this is the mean platelet volume is basically the volume of the platelets. Platelet distribution width is something akin to what you get from the RDW, similar kind of information. Again, platelet distribution width percentage, you can have a distribution width at the level of 20% in platelet histogram, something like what you use to get RDW-ST. Then platelet crit, which is the equivalent of hematocrit, IPF percentage, and platelet to large cell ratios. Now look at this, you have just so many information available from a hematology analyzer, which actually is giving you a lot of leeway to understand and, you know, treat the diseases. I will be doing a bit of a disservice if I do not touch the congenital thrombocytopenic syndromes, because they are also equally important, if not important totally, because majority are acquired, but congenital information also becomes important. And it's also important in today's day and world, especially considering that since the time we figured out what ITP is, we have taken almost 200 years to really give what is called thrombopoietic mimetics. Now, with that background of history, we need to remember, from the times till the time I was a postgraduate student, the disorders in the congenital, you know, platelet disorders were pretty limited, you know. And a lot of them, I would just remember two or three, which would be Bernard-Soulier, the Viscott-Aldrich, and of course the X-linked and, you know, Glanzmann's, etc. But you would probably really, really not bother beyond that, because majority of the times your questions for the exam would actually come from these only. Now, beyond 2000, I wonder how I would remember all these disorders. You know, just look at the number of disorders which have started coming up, and they're all linked to all these various kinds of mutations, and the picture is still continuing. You know, it's not actually finished as of now. So when you look at all of them, the inherited thrombocytopenic syndromes have now started gaining a lot of information from the times when they were, most of them were the unknown ones, to a day today where a lot of them have a known mutation with them. And of course, a lot of them will be actually diagnosed only by doing the mutation studies. However, there is a lot of information which can come from the hematology analyzers, and they can actually guide us to go ahead with such congenital or inherited thrombocytopenias. Just to give you information from one of these articles, which is there in this particular case, as you can see, what I'm showing you is these mean platelet distribution width in various disorders and how these disorders will have variability in their expression of the mean distribution of the platelet diameter, that's the mean platelet volume. Similarly, platelet diameter distribution width, which is otherwise called the PDW, and of course the platelet to large cell ratio and platelet to small cell ratio, all these becomes important. And when you're looking at all of them, you're actually able to classify all these diseases, because all of them will have some difference in their sizes, some difference in their platelet to large cell ratios. And if there is a congenital history of such patients, you will be able to take it further by looking at these platelet size parameters. So just to give you an idea, this is again from this paper, which talks about classification of the inherited thrombocytopenias according to the mean platelet distribution width and their mean distribute platelet volumes and the percentage of large platelets. So you're able to figure out diseases and group them according to the MPDs, which is in micrometers, and the large platelets in terms of percentage, and you're actually able to figure them out eventually once you're getting the mutation studies done. So if you look at it, the hematology analyzer is able to give you information from the mean platelet distribution and the large platelets, and from there you can then eventually figure out which particular group does it fall into. Also, if you look at platelet diameter per se, there are cutoffs which have been defined, basis which you are able to differentiate between various type of disease states. And as you can see in this particular table as well, you are having mean platelet volumes cutoff of more than 3.74 for patients where you're having a higher diseases like these ones where you have HMI, H9RD, etc., etc. So if I may give you a take-home message from my presentation, it's important to look at the complete blood count in totality. It is not only important to just look at the platelet count, you are expected to look at the platelet proportion of the complete blood count, which will include interpretation of the total platelet count relative to the reference interval. When you're only talking about numbers, you're expected to look at the mean platelet volume, look at the platelet distribution width, look at the platelet distribution histogram, look at the fluorescence parameters of the platelets, including the IPF. And if there are any steps to be taken to ensure that the platelets are counted appropriately and looked at appropriately, then you need to take those steps in the analysis as well. Eventually, look at the numerical parameters with platelet morphology on a smear, and of course, correlate the platelet results with the RBC and the WBC parameters for you to get a clinical assessment of the patient's value and eventually be contributing to the patient's benefit for understanding what the disease state patient has. So cytomorphometry for platelet counting is here to stay. And if you are able, and if you are actually looking at the platelet parameters in more discrete fashion than what we are doing today, I'm sure we will be able to give far better information for the patient treatment. Thank you very, very much for your kind attention. I will be happy to answer questions, if any.
Hello. So thanks, Dr. Anil Handu, for his lecture on platelet disorders and cytomorphometry, how cytomorphometry can help in platelet disorders. But as we know, the eastern population of India totally differs from rest of the India in terms of platelet. So now we have another lecture by Dr. Sangamitra, who will give her experience how eastern platelet differs from the rest of India. Let's welcome Dr. Sangamitra.
Hello, I'm Dr. Sangamitra Mukherjee Banerjee. I am a consultant pathologist and in charge quality lab, Emory Hospital, Salt Lake, Kolkata. I am attached to this institution for the past 12 years and I have been practicing pathology for more than 15 years. And I'm also an NABL assessor. Thanks. Good morning. Today I'm going to talk about Harry's platelet syndrome, a disorder which is less discussed. Congenital thrombocytopenias are nowadays not very uncommon. Congenital autosomal megakaryocytic thrombocytopenias, which are MYH9 related, they include May-Hagelin, Sebastian, Fechner and Epstein syndromes. However, a new syndrome was discovered or described by Naina et al. In the early 2000s, and it was characterized by mild to severe thrombocytopenia, giant platelets in the peripheral blood with a mean platelet volume more than 10 femtoliter. But these patients had normal platelet functions and they did not have any history of bleeding present in them. And this type of a conglomerate of symptoms were found in the blood donors of West Bengal. And when they were tested for platelet functions, their platelet functions were also normal and they did not have the MYH9 gene. This was termed as a new syndrome called Harris syndrome. In 2002, this was called ACMT or asymptomatic constitutional macrothrombocytopenia. However, this ACMT and CAMT, that is congenital megakaryocytic thrombocytopenia, they sounded a bit similar. So it was decided to avoid confusion that it should be given a new name, and that is how the name Harris platelet syndrome came into being, Harris being one of the authors in that, Naina et al. Harris platelet syndrome is nowadays the most common IGPD reported in the Indian subcontinent. Now, what are the actual findings in these patients, or this group of patients? The study in these blood donors who were diagnosed to be as patients of HPS, they showed statistically significant lower platelet counts, the median being 142. As we know, the normal range is from 150,000. These patients had counts lower than that. They had a higher MPV of a mean of 13.1, had a low platelet biomass. Their platelet distribution width was also very high. They had giant platelets on the peripheral blood smear, but none of these showed any abnormalities, that is, such as dual body inclusions in their leukocytes. If we go to the RBC parameters also, they had a slightly significant lower hemoglobin. RDW was slightly higher, but there was no RBC abnormality, morphological abnormality. And statistically, there was not much variation in MCV, MCH, MCHC, that is the RBC indices. Now, Naina et al. Found that these type of patients of this asymptomatic macrothrombocytopenias were distributed mainly in the eastern part of India. As we can see in this picture, it is mostly in West Bengal, Assam, part of eastern Bihar, some part of Orissa, mostly in the northern eastern states and sporadically in North India. We are at present studying this type of macrothrombocytopenias which are asymptomatic in our hospital. Right now the study has been halted a bit because of this situation of the pandemic, but I can show you some prototypes of the patients that we are getting. I'll show you 10 slides. As you can see in case study 1, this patient has a platelet count of 82, MPV is high, PCLR is also high, and PDW is high. If I scroll down for the next 9 cases, you will find similar picture. This is case 2 with a platelet of 60, MPV is quite high, 17.4. PCLR is also 75.4. Normally, it's up to 45. Case 3. I won't go to the details. As you can see in the slides, they have a similar type of picture. All of them have low platelet count, high MPV, and high PDW and high PCLR. I'll rapidly move through the next few slides having the same type of pictures. This is the peripheral smear blood picture that we can see, and this is the type that you can see, the giant platelet. Giant platelets. All these patients on their peripheral smear showed these giant giant platelets or erythrocyte. Now, key parameters therefore is low platelet count, high MPV. I'll reiterate it again. High PCLR, 48 platelet distribution. High width is more. Giant platelets and no toll bodies. At present, the diagnosis of HPS is mainly done by asserting the ethnicity of the patient, coming from which part of India, as well as we rule out any other cause that may lead to thrombocytopenias acquired, and any other, there is a history of congenital thrombocytopenias in the patient. Why is it important that we should know about this category of patients? Because we find that almost 1/3 of population of eastern part of the Indian continent has this blood picture. And most of them, unfortunately, if they are detected by screening or for some other disorders, they may be treated inappropriately with steroids, immunoglobulin infusions, and even splenectomy. So I conclude by saying that because in eastern part of India, this type of platelet disorder or this type of occurrence is common, so we need a modified normal range of platelets, because for people of eastern India, it is found that mostly they have low platelet counts. So, and this, there is a high prevalence of this high asymptomatic constitutional macrothrombocytopenias. And genetic studies to identify MYH9 gene mutation so that we can classify these thrombocytopenic cases into various categories is also important for further evaluation, treatment, whatever is required. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sangmitra, on a wonderful lecture on Eastern platelet as well as Harris platelet syndrome. We understand that differing platelet information in sitting in Eastern India is totally different from India, but you have shed a lot of useful light on that subject, and I'm sure the audience will be using that well. Now, I welcome Dr. Aditi Mittal, who will be discussing the novel parameters which are going to be useful on bone marrow recovery. Welcome, Dr. Aditi Mittal.
Hello, everyone. Myself, Dr. Aditi Mittal, and I am currently working as a senior resident in BRK Super Speciality Hospital. Hope you are staying safe and staying at home. So I'm going to speak on the role of IPF and IRF in assessing the bone marrow hematopoietic recovery post-transplant. So coming to hematopoietic stem cell transplant is a curative treatment done in hematologic malignancies and other some clinical conditions. Its main objective is to reconstitute the hematopoietic system of recipient by administering an infusion of donor hematopoietic stem cells. Transplant engraftment is the first sign of bone marrow recovery. And today in the era of the automated analyzers, life has become more easy, but there are various parameters which are provided by these analyzers and they are underutilized. So IPF and IRF are two of those parameters which can be used as predictors of marrow recovery and have been studied separately in various studies for platelet and ANC recovery respectively. So coming to IPF, which is immature platelet fraction, and it is most widely talked about parameter and recently introduced parameter in certain cell counters, and it defines newly released or so-called reticulated platelets and contains residual RNA and may be measured by flow cytometry using a fluorescent dye that binds RNA. So it is measured in the platelet F channel and analogous to reticulocytes. So what does it tells us that if the IPF is high, it indicates increased bone marrow thrombopoietic activity. And if the IPF is low, it indicates decreased bone marrow thrombopoietic activity. So now IRF, which is immature reticulocyte fraction. Normally in healthy individuals, reticulocytes circulate in the peripheral blood for 1 to 2 days after being released from the bone marrow before they lose sufficient RNA to become RBC. So during the periods of increased erythropoietic demand, the reticulocyte lifespan in peripheral blood increases to 3 or more days. Because of stress, the bone marrow starts producing immature or stressed reticulocytes in the peripheral blood. So till now, we have been doing the reticulocyte count manually, and there have been various observer variations. But automated analyzers has made it much easier for us. Some of the analyzers started giving automated reticulocyte count, which has permitted more precise counting of reticulocytes, as well as an objective measure of reticulocyte maturity based on their RNA content. It is now possible to precisely quantitate the proportion of all reticulocytes that is immature. And this is termed the immature reticulocyte fraction, or IRF. It is calculated as a ratio of immature reticulocytes to the total number of reticulocytes, and it includes both medium fluorescent reticulocytes and high fluorescent reticulocytes. So it says that if it is usually low in the aplastic condition, and IRF becomes high when the bone marrow is under stress and depopulating. So several studies suggested a rise in IPF predicts an increase in platelet count, and that increase in ANC are mirrored by IRF, but this prediction of engraftment can be a valuable asset to support clinical decisions such as administration of G-CSF or platelet transfusion, and can signal the start of bone marrow recovery. So the aim and objective of our study was to assess IPF and IRF as an early indicator of post-hematopoietic stem cell engraftment and which one is more reliable. So this is currently a pilot study, and we have collected around 32 samples comprising patients who underwent transplant between January 2020 and March 2020. And all the samples are collected in EDTA tube and performed within the 6 hours of peripheral blood collection. And IPF and IRF were determined by fluorescent and light scatter based methods using fluorescent RNA markers that enable distinction between immature and mature cell fractions. So the recovery criteria taken was neutrophil engraftment was defined as more than 500 for 3 consecutive days, and platelet engraftment as more than 20,000 for first 3 consecutive days. At our center, we also did another study to define the cutoff values for both IPF and IRF, and we took around 250 normal samples, and we found the range of 2.5 to 13.5 for IRF with a CV of 5% and IPF 1.1 to 19 with a CV of 12%. So total 32 cases was underwent transplant, out of which 14 were allogenic and 18 were autologous. And the mean IPF found to be 10.6 and mean IRF found on these cases was 28.25. So this is an example of one case. Similar findings were found in most of the cases. So here we can see that there is a significant jump on this. This orange line is IPF. This blue line is IRF and this green line is AMC. So we found it on day 7, we can see there is a significant jump in IRF, which is a blue line, from 2.2 to 6.9. And then after one day, there was a jump seen in IPF from 6 to 7.8. And after 2 days of this jump, there we can see a jump in ANC. The neutrophil engraftment has started occurring from 0.35 to 3.98. So this is the data of all 32 cases, and we found that ANC and platelets starts recovering within the 3 days of IRF and IPF jump. But out of these 32 cases, there were 3 cases in which ANC and platelet did not recover within 3 days. They recovered after the 3 days of IPF jump. But in these cases too, they recovered within the 3 days of IRF jump. So based on this data, we can say that IPF and IRF both can predict recovery, but IRF seems to be more reliable than IPF till now. Studies also like by Onofrio et al, which they said that HFR fraction was the earliest and most sensitive index of engraftment in 79.1% of patients. There is another study which is predictive value of immature reticulocyte and platelet fractions in hematopoietic recovery of allograft patients done by Goncalo et al, and they also observed that significant correlation between the neutrophil and platelet recovery with recoveries of the new parameters IRF and IPF, and concluded that IRF and IPF can predict hematopoietic recovery. So there is another study which is assessment of hematologic progenitor engraftment by complete reticulocyte maturation parameters after autologous and allogenic hematopoietic stem cell transplantation done by Torres et al. And they also said that early reticulocyte appear sooner than neutrophils after both autologous and allogenic transplants, and any determined reticulocyte parameter can reliably measure this fraction. There's one more study done by Zucker et al. In which they found that IPF is comparable to IRF hematopoietic recovery following peripheral blood transplantation. So conclusion till now of our study is that both IPF, that is immature platelet fraction, and IRF, immature reticulocyte fraction, can be used as reliable parameters as a predictor of post-transplant engraftment. And immature reticulocyte fraction seems to be more reliable than IPF. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Aditi Mittal, for letting us know that there are more parameters which can show us a response from bone marrow transplant other than absolute neutrophil count. Thanks for the lecture. I'm sure audience will benefit from it. And now I welcome Dr. Shahnaz Kodaiji, who will inform us that how platelet parameters are going to help us in cardiac diseases, because so far all the platelet parameters we know were helping us in dengue and other diseases. Now we are going to learn more from Dr. Shahnaz Kodaiji in platelet parameters in cardiac diseases.
Hello everyone. I'm Dr. Shahnaz Kodaiji, consultant hematopathologist at the Hinduja Hospital, Mumbai. Before I begin, I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to this webinar. Thank you. It is well known that platelets play an important role in the development of atherosclerosis and cardiovascular diseases. Today, I'm going to talk on platelet parameters in cardiac disease. So apart from the platelet count, the platelet indices that are obtained from our routine day-to-day automated hematology analyzers are the mean platelet volume, the platelet distribution width, the platelet large cell ratio, and the immature platelet fraction. And just to quickly recapitulate what these indices are, the most commonly used index or parameter is the mean platelet volume, which is a measure of the platelet size and normally ranges from 7.5 femtoliters to 10.5 femtoliters. However, this range can vary from instrument to instrument. The platelet parameter that we commonly see, though it is not of much use in our routine CBC, is the platelet distribution width, which is a measure of the platelet size variation, much as the RDW is a measure of the different sizes of RBCs. The normal reference range for PTW is 9 to 14%. And the other parameter, which is now available to us on many of the top-end hematology analyzers is the platelet large cell ratio, which is the proportion of platelets which are large platelets, which are greater than 12 femtoliters, and they lie in this region of the platelet curve. So the normal range for the platelet large cell ratio is less than 30% of the total platelet population. And then we have the image of platelet fraction, which is now available to us on most modern hematology analyzers, which use the optical and the fluorescence mode for platelet counting. These image of platelets are large reticulated platelets, and you can see that they are very distinct from the tight platelet cluster of small platelets, and then there are these large platelets which lie high on the FFC. They are available on many of the newer modern hematology analyzers. The IPF is usually high when there is peripheral consumption or destruction of platelets, because when the platelet count goes low, there is a stimulus to the bone marrow to form more platelets. And this is usually, high IPF is usually seen in conditions like ITP and TTP. And the IPF is low in cases of bone marrow failure syndrome, such as aplastic anemia. The published reference range for IPF is 0.9 to 7%. The range that we have established here at Hinduja Hospital is 0.7 to 4.3%. And this is what a printout from the machine looks like. And these are the platelet parameters, which all appear in a row: the platelet distribution width, the mean platelet volume, the platelet large cell ratio, and the platelet grid. And you also, if the sample is run in an optical or fluorescence mode, then the image of platelet fraction also appears on that report. So platelet volume indices have been evaluated in individuals with risk factors for cardiovascular disease. Recent studies that have investigated the association between these indices and individual risk factors such as obesity, diabetes, and hypertension have shown promising results for MPV, or the mean platelet volume, as an indicator of platelet activation even before the onset of the cardiovascular disease. Thus, these platelet indices are potential subclinical markers for cardiovascular disease. And even the PDW, which we don't find much use of, as I already told you, in a CBC, has been studied in these conditions, and it shows promising results. So now, why do these platelets increase in size in these conditions, in cardiovascular diseases or in patients with atherosclerosis? So we find that most of these individual risk factors, such as obesity, diabetes, and arterial hypertension, all have a common underlying pathophysiology, and all of these eventually result in the formation of oxidative stress, inflammation, insulin resistance, endothelial dysfunction, reduced calcium metabolism, reduced nitric oxide, and an increased phosphorylation and glycosylation of the plasma proteins. All these together act on the platelets to activate platelets. And when platelets are activated, they become hyperaggregable. They form clumps because they stick to one another. And therefore, this is a stimulus for the bone marrow to form more platelets. And the bone marrow then churns out young, large reticulated platelets. And as this is an ongoing process in these patients with cardiovascular risk factors, there is a constant production by the bone marrow of these large reticulated platelets. Larger platelets are metabolically and enzymatically more active because they contain more alpha granules, which contain all the procoagulants such as fibrinogen, von Willebrand factor, etc. And they also produce more thrombexane and show high expression of adhesive glycoproteins. Sorry. Now, in conditions such as unstable angina, there is ongoing platelet consumption resulting in the production of young, larger platelets which are hyperaggregable. And these affect and promote the formation of a thrombus, which leads to the limitation of blood flow and acute cardiac ischemia. So, altered platelet indices are seen in cardiovascular diseases such as acute myocardial infarction, unstable angina, and sudden cardiac death. And their importance in these coronary artery diseases and in acute coronary syndrome is indirectly confirmed by the fact that we see benefit of antiplatelet therapy such as aspirin, clopidogrel and GP2B3A inhibitors in these patients. Platelet hyperreactivity and local platelet activation play a causal role in these acute coronary events. And now we would, I'll just take you through some articles in which they have established an association between platelet volume indices and cardiovascular risk factors. And this is in fact a very good and exhaustive review article which has discussed each individual cardiovascular risk factor and its effect on the platelet volume indices. So these indices, platelet indices, have been studied as possible biomarkers for predicting risk of cardiovascular disease in obese patients. In these patients, the leptin hormone is increased and therefore this contributes to the hyperreactivity of the platelets. Another study done on 108 children showed that obese children with non-alcoholic fatty liver disease have a significantly higher MPV than non-obese children. A study done on diabetes patients demonstrated that the value of MPV and PDW was significantly higher among the patients with diabetes compared to those who did not have diabetes. Now, even in these diabetic patients, those who had a hemoglobin A1C level of more than 7% showed a higher MPV and PDW than those with a hemoglobin A1C of less than 7%. Another study compared the MPV values between subjects without diabetes mellitus and those who had a pre-diabetic syndrome. And they observed that the MPV was significantly higher in the pre-diabetic group as compared to the non-diabetic group. A study by Booth et al. Showed that patients with a high-risk arterial hypertension and malignant hypertension had higher MPV than subjects without hypertension. The PDW also was significantly higher among these who had malignant arterial hypertension compared to individuals without this disease. So it is clearly established that all these factors have an impact on the platelet volume indices and that the platelet volume indices can predict these, can predict the occurrence of cardiovascular disease in these patients. And then there are also many studies which have done to establish the association of platelet indices with patients who have developed cardiovascular diseases. And there is this one very large and good system, review and meta-analysis, which has included 24 studies and over 6,000 subjects. And the results of this support the hypothesis that elevated MPV is a cardiovascular risk factor and that it is associated with adverse cardiovascular events. The salient findings from this study are that there is a significant difference in the MPV when between acute myocardial infarction and non-AMI populations. And in the non-AMI populations, this study has included patients with stable coronary artery disease or patients who have no coronary artery disease. Then the second point is that an elevated MPV was associated with increased mortality following myocardial infarction. And also it noted that among patients who had undergone coronary angioplasty, MPV was significantly higher in those patients who developed a restenosis. Therefore, this clearly shows an association of high MPV with adverse cardiac events. Then there was this article from India, which looked at platelet volume indices in patients with coronary artery disease and acute myocardial infarction. And this study attempted to study platelet parameters in spectrum of ischemic artery disease and to find a clinico-pathological correlation between the two. This was a prospective hospital-based study done on 210 patients over a period of 1 year. And these authors divided their study group into study population into three groups. Group A were patients from ICU who had unstable angina or acute myocardial infarction. Group B was a group of patients who had stable coronary artery disease and they may have had an angiography or a CABG at some previous occasion. But they were stable at the time that they were included in the study. And the third was an age and sex match control group. and what these authors found that the MPV, mean MPV, between the patients of the acute myocardial infarction group was significantly different from the normal MPV. This is our study group, and they find that with a cutoff value of 10.43, an MPV is easily able to differentiate or easily able to predict the cardiovascular risk in these patients. Many such studies have done, and many have found a significance between patients with high risk and normal MPVs. So this clearly establishes an association between high MPV and the occurrence of acute myocardial infarction in patients with high risk. Then there is this other study which studied mean platelet volume and platelet large cell ratio as prognostic factors for coronary artery disease and myocardial infarction. And they found that the MPV correlates with the severity of the coronary artery disease. In myocardial infarction, high MPV is linked with non-reperfusion phenomenon and is related to the increased mortality. That means the MPV is linked with poor risk. Thus, platelet indices such as MPV and P platelet large cell ratio may be utilized as parameters of various risk scores to assess outcomes in patients of coronary artery diseases and acute coronary syndrome. And then there was also a study which is done on IPF in coronary artery disease. The study found that smokers and diabetics have an increased IPF. Therefore, these are the risk factors for coronary artery disease. IPF is high in patients with acute coronary syndrome, especially in patients who show an ST segment elevated myocardial infarction. This parameter is easily measured on automated hematology analyzers and therefore can add a new dimension to predicting cardiovascular risk. The benefits or the advantages of using MPV to diagnose early risk for cardiovascular patients is that MPV is very simple, inexpensive, and easy to perform. And therefore, it is a very practical parameter. Patients with larger platelets can easily be identified during routine CBC. It is prognostically important biomarker for cardiovascular disease, and early detection of platelet activation, especially in high-risk groups, can be useful in identifying patients with increased thrombotic risk even before the actual cardiovascular event happens, so that preventive measures can be implemented earlier on in these patients and you may prevent the occurrence of some fatal or high morbidity event. Platelet indices provide an important, simple, effortless, and cost-effective tool which can be useful in predicting an impending acute coronary event. Now, obviously, measurement of platelet indices have some limitations, and these are that the values vary with anticoagulants use. It is mostly standardized on EDTA because EDTA is the anticoagulant used for performing CBCs, but many times platelets are also collected in citrate, and you will find that the MPV on the citrated blood and the EDTA blood will not match. Therefore, standardization has to be done and some harmonization. The analysis should be performed early, within 2 hours after collection, because platelets have a tendency to swell and therefore the platelet volume will increase. Then lack of standardization regarding the methodology which is used. The hematology analyzers can directly interfere in the comparability of results. Therefore, it is very difficult to compare results from one lab to the other, or even from one instrument to the other. And each instrument has to be, first a study has to be done to establish a normal range for your population on every instrument. There are lack of reference values which have not yet been established. So all these are the limitations for using these parameters. And in conclusion, I would just like to quote one or two studies which have established an association between platelet indices and cardiovascular diseases. One is that the MPV is increased before a myocardial infarction event, and the MPV value taken 6 months after the myocardial infarction is an independent risk factor for recurrence of myocardial infarction. In other words, if the NPV remains persistently high even after the patient has recovered, this patient is very likely to have a recurrence. A large study of over 2 lakh patients showed high NPV was associated with high risk in patients with acute ischemic cardiovascular events, and therefore we could possibly use this NPV as an individual risk factor. All these parameters can be easily picked up on routine CBC. That is a major advantage of these parameters. And early monitoring can help to control risk factors, that is hypertension, hyperlipidemia, smoking, etc. So if you're routinely doing a CBC and you're picking up high NPV on patients who you already know have these risk factors, you can easily counsel these patients and treat the risk factors. And in view of all the studies and all the good corroborative evidence, we can conclude that these parameters can be included as risk factors for coronary artery disease and myocardial infarction. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shanath Kuraiji, for a wonderful lecture on platelet parameters in cardiac diseases. I'm sure everyone who listened to this lecture would benefit from it. Now I welcome Dr. Amita Sharaf from Gangaram Hospital, who will be sharing her experience on platelet parameters on prostate diseases. Welcome, Dr. Amita Sharaf.
I'm Dr. Amrita Saraf. I'm working as senior consultant in Department of Hematology at Sir Gangaram Hospital. So it's a pleasure to join this meeting today, and I would like to share my views and a part of a small study on the platelets, which basically highlights role of new platelet parameter in cases with prostatomegaly to differentiate between the malignancy versus benign condition, that is BPH. And I would also like to thank the whole MINRAID team and the organizers to give me this opportunity to speak and share my views on this topic. Thank you. Yeah, so today I would like to share my views and the findings of a small study to highlight the role of newer platelet parameters in patients with prostatomegaly to differentiate between malignancy from benign prostatic hyperplasia. As we know that prostatic cancer is one of the most common malignancies which affects the men worldwide, and PSA, that is prostate specific antigen, is used as a diagnostic marker to detect this cancer, but elevation in this level have also been noted in other conditions, which include prostatitis, BPH, that is benign prostatic hyperplasia, and also after post-digital rectal examination. In the studies, it has also been seen that around 15 to 25% of cancer patients, prostatic cancer patients, also show normal PSA level. So this marker cannot be really used as a reliable cancer marker. It has been demonstrated that there is no certain level of PSA which can be thought of definitive for prostate cancer, because the value keep on varying when we use it for screening, diagnosis, prognosis, and also as a signal of recurrence. So this gives rise to a need to find out a new biomarker which can differentiate cancer prostate from BPH, and it can help us to improve the current diagnostic methods and prevent unnecessary biopsies, as well as to avoid overtreatment. Now coming to platelet parameters, as we know that MPV, mean platelet volume, is used as an index for activated platelets and its association with different kinds of cancer, which include gastric cancer, ovarian cancer, lung cancer, CA colon, and breast cancer. It has been already established in literature. On the other side, PDW is also an indicator which denotes variation in the platelet size, and this also has been used widely to diagnose various conditions which affect platelet size and platelet count. And we know that using state-of-the-art hematology analyzers, it's very easy to get these parameter value, the PDW and MPV, when we run the sample to get our complete blood count parameter. So there is nothing very special or nothing very high-fi. It's just part of our routine CBC analysis, which we can do in our EDTA sample. But it has seen that there is a limited data regarding the utility of these marker, that is MPV and PDW, to differentiate between cancer prostate and BPH. The mechanism underlying the association of these indices and cancer prostate are currently unclear, but platelets are supposed to play an important role in the progress of cancer, and it is spread as per the literature. In a recent study in 2018, it was found that cancer prostate patients, they show reduced MPV and elevation in PSA and PDW levels when the data was compared to that of BPH patients. So we decided to go for a diagnostic study, which basically was conducted enrolling the patients who presented with prostatomegaly. And the utility of these markers, which includes PSA, MPV, and PDW, was evaluated as a predictor of malignancy in these patients with histopathology taken as gold standard. So the objective of this study was to evaluate the diagnostic utility of prostatic specific antigen, mean platelet volume, and platelet distribution width to predict prostate cancer in patients with prostatomegaly. This study was carried out in the Department of Urology at Sir Gangaram Hospital, and the workup was done in Department of Hematology, Biochemistry, and Histopathology since June 2018, and the data was analyzed till May this year. The study is still going on, but I would like to share our experience till the data analyzed till May 2020. So this study population consists of patients who presented with prostatomegaly, which was more than 30 cc of volume, and where the histopathological diagnosis was confirmed either by biopsy or by post-surgery tissue analysis. So total 88 patients were included in this analysis, of which 65 were found to be suffering from BPH and 23 from cancer prostate. The serum PSA levels were measured in peripheral blood using an automatic electrochemistry luminescence immunoassay system, and the hematological parameters, which included CBC, MPV, and PDW, were measured by collecting peripheral blood in EDTA tube, and it was analyzed on a fully automated hematology autoanalyzer. There was paraffin processes tissue, which was stained with HND stain, were examined for histopathology, and the malignancy was diagnosed by the presence of neoplastic proliferation of glands with fibromuscular stroma, with cuboidal lining, hyperchromatic nuclei with prominence of nucleoli, and there were presence of back-to-back arrangement of neoplastic glands, which is classical findings of adenocarcinoma. And the benign tissue was also identified by scattered glands when there was proliferation of that benign tissue and cuboidal epithelium lining without any evidence of anaplasia. The inclusion criteria and exclusion criteria were also well defined. So the patients who presented with prostatomegaly underwent surgical resection or biopsy, and where the diagnosis was confirmed by histopathology, whether it was benign or malignant, were included in the study. And the patients with hematological disorder, which was based on their clinical criteria, red cell indices, peripheral blood film findings, which included iron deficiency, myeloproliferative neoplasm, TTP, megaloblastic anemia, and aplastic anemia, they were excluded. And also cases with liver cirrhosis, diabetes, thyroid, hypo or hyperfunctioning, and the history of treatment with anticoagulant, statin, and aspirin were excluded from this analysis. So now coming to the clinical and lab characteristics of the patient. As we can see here, we had 88 patients, out of which 23 patients were diagnosed as cancer prostate, and 65 were detected to have BPH. So coming to the variables, which includes age, hemoglobin, TLC, platelets, RBC, RDW, size of the prostate, PDW, MPV, and PSA, we can see that the range of patients in terms of age, these are the mean values, and then the range of the patient varying from minimum to maximum. So we can see that the difference between the cancer patients and the BPH, and if we see that in terms of prosthetic size, there was like cancer prostate were not that enlarged as compared to BPH, and the PDW, MPV, PSA also showed little difference in the findings in terms of which will be discussed later in terms of statistical significance. So now highlighting the three parameters which we are going to discuss here now. The PDW showed a mean of 15.09 in cancer patient versus 13.5 in BPH with SD of plus minus 3.46 and plus minus 2.89 respectively. So the p-value came to be less than 0.05. The MPV showed in cancer patient it was 11.82 versus in BPH 11.13, and ranging from 9.9 to 15.2 in cancer patients and 8 to 13.9 in BPH with median of 11.7 versus 11.2. The p-value here also came less than 0.05. Now coming to PSA levels, as we can see that there is significant difference in the value 32.7 in cancer patients and 4.6 in BPH, with a range varying from 3.2 to 192.6 in cancer and 0.14 to 29.1 in BPH, with a significant p-value which was less than 0.0001. This is the ROC curve for PSA, MPV, and PDW, where we can see the sensitivity versus 1 minus specificity using all these variables, which includes individual parameters of PSA, MPV, PDW, combination of PSA and MPV, PSA and PDW, and all the three parameters together. So this ROC curve analysis showed utility of markers, which are single as well as combined, to differentiate cancer patients from BPH. And we can see the sensitivity, specificity, area under curve, and p-value for all these single and combined values. So here the MPV, we can see the MPV PDW showed sensitivity of around 65.2 versus 58.5 specificity. And the PDW also showed 52.2 and 61.5. The PSA showed 95.7% sensitivity and 75.4% specificity. The combination of two is almost, it's actually same, 91.3 for whether it was with MPV or PDW when PSA was combined with any of these two parameters. But there is a difference in the specificity. And when they were combined together, it showed a sensitivity of 82.6 with a specificity of 80 with area under curve lesser than PSA value alone and with the combination. So coming to the discussion, as we see, as per this data, PSA is markedly higher in these cancer patients than in BPH, and it showed 95.7% sensitivity and 75.4% specificity. So which is actually well known that PSA was being, it has been always been used as a marker for cancer patients. And PDW was higher in prostate cancer cases, and MPV also being little higher in cancer patients as compared to BPH. As we can see that there is a difference in the number of patients of BPH and cancer prostate. So we know that 65 cases of BPH versus 23 cases of cancer prostate. So this may be a reason to explain the statistically significant difference in the p-value when there was a comparison. For MPV and PDW, we could not find a proper cutoff, but the combination of PSA with PDW PSA with MPV, and three of these together, that is PSA, PDW and MPV, they showed better sensitivity and specificity as compared to individual MPV and PDW parameter. So here we know that the study has few limitations. That is, one is a smaller number of cases are included because it was a time-bound study, and cancer prostate cases being much lesser as compared to BPH. So there is actually a need to correlate the parameters with prostatitis and further histopathological subtyping and grading of adenocarcinoma, which was not actually mentioned here, which was not included in the analysis. So our study showed that AUC value, the area under curve values for discriminating cancer prostate patients from BPH, ranged from 0.620 for PDW, 0.633 for MPV to 0.916 for PSA respectively. And the combination of PSA with MPV increased this area under curve to a significant 0.925, which was higher than those of those for any single marker. So after this all, coming to the conclusion, as per this data analysis, MPV and PDW independently showed lesser sensitivity and specificity as compared to PSA. A combination of PSA with MPV, PSA with PDW, and three of these parameters together, that is PSA, MPV, and PDW, might show promising results. And therefore, there is a need of these results to be validated with additional investigation and larger studies. They are required to demonstrate their application to differentiate between BPH and cancer prostate in all these cases with prostatomegaly. So we can actually get this advantage from this study, that it gives insight to actually find out that these newer parameters, which are not really expensive one or very hi-fi parameters, which for which we need to spend extra money or to make an extra effort, but with the simple CBC, which we can do on an EDTA sample, we can find these parameters, and it might show us promising results because there are previous studies, and even this study gives us a clue that if we do a larger study and we can include other parameters like histopathological grading and evidence of concurrent prostatitis, may give us valuable result, and it might help us in differentiation between this benign and malignant condition in prostatomegaly, which is actually a very common clinical finding in males. Thank you.
So I must thank Dr. Amita Sharaf on her experience with platelet parameters in prostate diseases, which was almost an unexplored territory. So I'm sure everybody would benefit from it. Now I must invite Dr. Dharmendra, who is going to share his experience on platelet reflex testing and how it is going to improve his TAT, because that is something which everybody look forward. Welcome, Dr. Dharmendra.
Myself, Dr. Dharmendra Rathore, consulting pathologist at Dr. Bhatt Pathology Laboratory. Today I want to share my experience about platelet reflux testing, so it is helpful to streamline our workflow. Nowadays, advanced hematology analyzer includes lots of new parameters, out of which we will discuss on platelet profiles. Platelet profile includes many parameters. Out of that, three parameters are based on the number of the platelets. That is platelet, IPF, and optical. And remaining five parameters are based on size of the platelets. Platelet count will be measured in platelet RBC chamber. Due to common chamber, interference will occur and the problem will arise in particular pathological conditions. You all are very much aware about impedance method, so we will not go into the details. Platelet histogram based on volume size 2 to 20 femtoliter, where lower and upper discriminator is plotting and one fixed discriminator at 12 femtoliter. So more than 12 femtoliter platelet sizes are counted in the S2 region. So the formula of platelet large cell ratio is S2 region platelet divided by total platelet multiplied by 100. This is the conventional RBC platelet measurement histogram. What will happen in the pathological conditions? RBC histogram overlapping the platelet histogram. So whenever there is a microcytic RBCs, fragmented RBCs, large platelets, giant platelets or platelet aggregates, where we can get the incorrect platelet count. These are the conditions where we can get false increase or false decrease platelet count. Whenever there is a fragmented RBCs or WBC fragments, microcytic RBCs, bacteria, cryoglobulins, where we can get false increase platelet count. And in scenarios such as the platelet aggregates, giant platelets or platelet satellitism, where we can get the false decreased platelet count. So in all these pathological conditions, we will get incorrect platelet count will affect our turnaround time. So what is the solution? It also disturbs our workflow. So there is a multi-arm test, where we can get reflux testing, rerun testing and repeat testing. Out of that, we will discuss on reflux testing. What means the reflux? Reflux testing means add some test items such as RAT or optical platelet in case of suspected results for the parameters based on rules set by the lab users. So the cell counter automatically distributes the samples with reflux criteria, which are predefined by the users. And it also improves the turnaround time by reducing the smear reviews. Now I would like to discuss about newer technology regarding platelet count, which is based on the principle of optical plus fluorescence, which is highly reliable in extremely abnormal samples. Here you can see the scatterogram, forward scatter versus fluorescence light, where the microcytic RBC populations are below the mature bluish population of the RBC and grayish oval area, that is for the large platelet size population. So that is clearly differentiated from the microcytic RBCs. And sky blue populations are the normal platelet size population. Advantages of the optical platelet. Here we can see the platelet histogram. When there is a condition of microcytic RBCs, then upper discriminator of platelet curve does not touch the baseline and RBC curve does not start with the baseline. In the scatterogram, we are showing the dense population of platelet in the sky blue region, that is the MPV less than 12, and the microcytic RBCs are in the bluish population, that is away from the platelet count. And in another scenario, when there is a giant platelet present in the sample, MPV was more than 12, so the large platelet are fall in the sky blue scattered dots population. So this is the advantage of the optical platelet over the impedance technology. This is again advantage of the low size platelet. When there is a sample with the less than 2 femtoliter size, impedance technology will not count it because technical limitation, there is a background noise. So in this optical principle, platelet are stained with the fluorescence, and with the advanced algorithm, it will count the less than 2 femtoliter size platelet. So we can get the accurate platelet count. In another scenario, when there is a RBC fragment count present, then it will mix up with the platelet count and we will get the incorrect platelet count in impedance technology. But in optical platelet, scattergram showing the bluish scattered dots in yellow oval circle, which is away from the platelet, that is the fragmented red cell population. So we will get the accurate platelet count in fragmented RBC conditions also. Now I want to show you few cases which came across in our laboratory regarding incorrect platelet count. First case was large or giant platelet and incorrect platelet count. 27-year-old male patient came with a mild fever. Having the CBC data, WBC count was 14,320. MPV was 16.3, that is higher than the normal range. And platelet large cell ratio was 67, which is also very much high. And the platelet count by impedance is 89,000. So this is a case of thrombocytopenia. And we will get platelet clump and abnormal platelet histogram. So based on the reflex criteria, when there is a MPV more than 12 and PLCR more than 50 along with the abnormal histogram, instrument will do reflex testing and we will get the optical platelet count, that is 1,51,000, that is near normal. We will see on the instrument screen PLCR 67. Here you can see the platelet histogram where the upper discriminator of platelet curve does not touch the baseline and it is merged with the RBC curve. So the large platelet were not counted in the impedance technology due to their limitation. We can get incorrect platelet in impedance technology. Here you can see in the scattergram, large platelet populations are on the total green color dots, which is away from the RBCs, and large platelets are counted in the optical channel. IPF was 27.9, also high. This is a large platelet, the microscopic image. These are the lots of poses of large platelet. So if we do only in the impedance technology, we will miss the poses of the large platelet. Second case of microcytosis with incorrect platelet count. 32-year-old pregnant lady having the CBC data, hemoglobin was only 4.5 gram. MCV was only 37.9, that is very low. And the platelet count was 2,29,000 in impedance, absolutely normal. Along with the flag, platelet histogram abnormal. Based on the reflex criteria, MCV was less than 58 along with the abnormal histogram of platelet. Instrument will do the reflex testing and we had get 1,15,000 platelet in optical channel. So this is a case of thrombocytopenia. Here what is happened, microcytic RBCs are counted in the platelet region by the impedance technology. So we will get the false increased platelet count. Actually platelet count was 1,15,000, that is a thrombocytopenia. Here you can see the microcytic RBCs in the scattergram, bluish population, which is away from the platelet. So in optical, we will get the correct platelet count. In this case, microcytic RBCs 80.7%. So it is very much high. This is a microscopic image of microcytic RBCs. So these are the causes of thrombocytopenia, which we missed in the impedance technology. Third case was RBC fragments and incorrect platelet count. 52-year-old lady, known case of chronic kidney disease, having the CBC data of WBC 3380, RBC count was low 2.34, hemoglobin was 5 gram, and the platelet count by impedance was 1,11,000. Along with the flag platelet clump, abnormal platelet histogram, anisocytosis and microcytosis. Based on the reflex criteria, RBC count was less than 3 and along with the abnormal platelet histogram instrument will do the reflex testing. So, we can get optical platelet 65,000 only. So, the fragmented RBCs which got counted in the impedance as a platelet. So, we can get the false increased platelet count. Here you can see the fragmented RBC percentage, that is 10.11%, which is also very much high. Here you can see in the microscopic image fragmented RBCs. Fourth case was platelet aggregates with the incorrect platelet count. 17-year-old male patient came with mild fever and weakness. Having the WBC count was 14,600 with the normal platelet count by impedance 286,000 with the platelet flag, abnormal histogram and platelet clumps. So based on the reflex criteria, instrument will do the reflex testing. So we can get the optical platelet as 597,000. That is very much high. So this is a case of thrombocytosis. So the aggregates of the platelets which were not counted in the impedance technology, so we will get the false decrease count. Here you can see the dense population of the platelet count in the scatterogram. This is the image of platelet satellitism, where the platelets are attached nearer to the leukocytes. While examining the smear of thrombocytopenic patient, make sure to examine the edges of the smear since the platelet clumps may migrate there. Here you can see the platelet clumps at the tail of the smear. So we will miss it otherwise. These are the lots of causes of increased platelet count, that is the thrombocytosis, which will be missed in the impedance technology. So my take home message was, use of reflex testing with advanced parameter will solve issues of incorrect platelet counts, particularly in pathological conditions, and it also improves the turnaround time. Hope this session will help you in one or other way. Thank you very much.
With this, I must thank all the speakers for their wonderful sessions. Now it's over to chairperson for question and answer session.
Good afternoon, everyone. And I think we have a wonderful session. MindRay has raised a platform way above many places for the kind of sessions we have had. We don't have many time because we have something else going on. A great discussion is there after this. So may I start a question with Dr. Raman, please? Dr. Raman, what is the role of cell microscopic morphology? What is the role of cell microscopic morphology and flow cytometry in the era of AI and next generation sequencing?
Okay, do you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you, yes. Sir.
Yeah, the thing is, today the doctors still use the stethoscope, the phonendoscope, for the examination. I think it's crucial. Of course, CT scan will be better. But we cannot miss simple and sometimes complicated things, don't use it basic technologies. I think morphology will remain forever because you have an approach, maybe qualitative, not quantitative, because flow cytometry and the instrumentation is better, but you cannot miss that. I can mention, for example, a case that I had in my practice, a CLL that came acute lymphoblastic leukemia over the CLL. How you can do a diagnosis with an instrument of flow cytometer with that? But if you make a simple examination of the smear qualitative, you cannot miss it. Or using flow cytometry, sometimes that these B blasts are so negative for the B marker that you can count as a debris. But of course, looking at the smear, you are going to see that they are blast, and you are going to see if the flow cytometry is really able to capture. The same flow cytometry. What is the role today of flow cytometry? I think will be a screening. We only need today to classify in multiple myeloma, acute lymphoblastic, acute myeloblastic, but flow cytometry plays an important role. The positivity for CD45 of the malignant cells will help a lot to differentiate acute and chronic. And I think these technologies, morphology and flow, will be qualitative, maybe not quantitative, but because next generation sequencing, we have seen today in thrombopenia, next generation sequencing will be like now for the COVID, the polymerase chain reaction, the PCR, you know, will be the standard in the next years. But I think these techniques are obligated to do it, but maybe not so complicated, maybe not with a lot of monoclonals and a lot of colors. Maybe only 3-4 colors will be enough. And the morphology, again, only qualitative, but will be absolutely necessary.
Thank you, Dr. Ramon. I have a question for Dr. Handu also. Thank you, Dr. Handu. Yours was a fabulous presentation, as usual. And, you know, I've heard you a number of times. Everybody is a little worried about low platelet counts. So how should one approach a low platelet count prior to a report release? Do you follow any algorithm for that?
So I think the answer to your question has been made pretty easy by the speaker who spoke the last. Dr. Rathod has actually given a fantastic algorithm. I think most of us follow the similar kind of an algorithm. What happens is that you initially put up the sample in an impedance mode. You have put an auto algorithm within your systems where whenever there is any flagging of the platelet count, it eventually is put into an optical mode or the fluorescence mode. And when you have issues there as well, then obviously a smear review makes it far better. So therefore, a similar algorithm, which Dr. Rathod said, I think that is what most of us do and is probably the most plausible way to do it as well.
Thank you, Dr. Handu. There have been a few questions which have come also on platelet clumps and aggregates of platelets. And does it become difficult to distinguish him? How do you pick it up? This has basically come from the audience. So I think that's the thing which worries a lot of us, you know, that we get a different count, then we look at the smear, then we feel it is giant platelets. So under those circumstances, how do you suggest that, you know, we should report such cases? It's going to come now along with the dengue and other things. So every time, we are just match it with the those are the things which go on. Is there any suggestion which you can give on that?
So the suggestion is as open as anybody else. If you look at it, the platelet counts, the moment they, the platelets, the moment they adhere to one another, it is practically very difficult to say, disaggregate them and, start counting them accurately.
Right.
None of the analyzers, if I may put it on record, none of the analyzers really has the capacity to handle, counts when the platelets are aggregated.
Yeah.
We need to remember that platelets, the moment they aggregate, they will obviously interfere in your RBC patterns also, especially when you're dealing with an impedance-based counter. We also need to remember that the good thing is, as long as the analyzer is able to pick them up and say, look, guys, there is a platelet aggregate probably in this sample, and you need to look at a smear just to identify whether it's there or not, that should be good enough. The biggest challenge which you face, however, is when you have satellitism, as was mentioned in the presentation by Dr. Rathod as well. In such cases, the analyzer, invariably will fail and you will really not be able to pick up such kind of issues when the analyzers work. So, honestly speaking, when I would ask my mentor, Dr. Sood, what to do in such cases, he would say, search me. And I think I would probably end with that as well. Search me. I really don't know a perfect answer for this, but the answer would be with respect to platelet counts. When you have such clumps there, the best thing would be to mention it in your report that, there are clumps and it's likely that the counts would be perhaps in the normal range. And maybe a repeat counting in a different anticoagulant would help. So that's probably my take on this.
Okay, thank you, sir. Because, we just report as clumps are there, but we don't. Some people actually do the count, and I'm a little worried about the counts when you do it on a, peripheral smear, because objectively, I may find something else and they may find, so there can be a lot of variations. So
yes,
that
of course.
Has always been, apparently normal or near normal is what we can give.
Yes.
But I don't think we should give the actual count as such.
Yes, I agree with you on that. And we are actually in the subsequent debate, which is there between me and Dr. Naveen Kakkad, I'm touching a little bit upon that as well.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Dr. Sangamitra, you had a really interesting study, from Eastern area. And why is it really important to recognize the entity Harris platelet syndrome, which you mentioned?
Actually, inherited macrothrombocytopenias, of which Harris platelet syndrome is a part, it's often misdiagnosed as ITP. And ITP has a very high incidence in our parts. So if we don't recognize this entity, you will find that patients may be unnecessarily investigated, even like bone invasive procedures like bone marrow, then even get treated unnecessarily with splenectomy or steroid therapy. Elective surgeries, invasive procedures require a pre-operative or pre-procedure checkup. And if thrombocytopenia often detected, may even delay these procedures, and Harris syndrome is a non-threatening macrothrombocytopenia. It is present in the population. Patients do not have any family history, do not have any bleeding history, and it is non-threatening. And so this must be actually separated from those which is threatening or which may give some clinical presentations. Small labs have three-part analyzers, and for them, they have low platelet counts. Often that is not matched with the peripheral smear, and this must be done, otherwise there will be unnecessary diagnostic evaluation, inappropriate therapy. So that is why it is important. Another thing that I feel important is that, because it is so much prevalent in the population in the eastern part of our country, northeast, in West Bengal especially, then Assam, parts of Bihar, Orissa, that we should actually develop a modified biological reference interval so that people are not unnecessarily treated, investigated. It involves a lot of pain for the patient, even monetary pain and everything. That is why I feel that is important to recognize this thing, develop a new, a modified biological reference interval and interpret, the platelet histograms properly. We are getting PDWs and all that. And correlate it properly with your peripheral smear. Look for any abnormalities in the neutrophils. It may suggest an inherited disorder.
Thank you, doctor. I mean, there may be variations across the country for that matter, east and west and north and south.
Yeah, actually much studies have been not done for the rest of India. Eastern India studies have been done. It actually came from south. The investigations into blood donors of West Bengal actually came from Vellore. We need more studies. in the other parts, whether it's prevalent even there.
Right. Or maybe something else, So I think that's required. Dr. Aditi, this was a fabulous thing which you did. And I congratulate you on your presentations.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes. It has been proven before that IPF and IRF predict, post-transplant recovery. In what contribution is your study going to make to that?
Actually, ma'am, we wanted to evaluate both IPF and IRF head-to-head in our setting, and such studies has not been done in our country. So I took this study to evaluate these parameters. And
So it has been helpful in that area, right? Yes, Dr. Aditi? Dr. Handu, could you help also with this?
Okay, so I'll just let you know about this particular study. This happens, we happen to be one of the largest transplant centers in the country. Vellore, of course, takes the lead there as well. And since we do a lot of transplants, there is always a question, when is the patient going to recover? Because you're looking at that elusive neutrophil, which you're looking at that 500 ANC and stuff like that. So there's always a question, do I transfuse this patient with the platelets? Do I don't? What do we do with respect to the red cells, et cetera, et cetera? So under these circumstances, we took this study to actually evaluate when, if we have the values of IRF and IPF available with us, would it be possible for us to predict that, you know, we can stop transfusing the patient? Because as you would know, that in all the cases of bone marrow transplant, there is a huge requirement of platelet transfusions as well as the transfusions of red cells and other products. So the idea was to ensure that if there is a parameter which can help us and guide us and tell us beforehand that, you know, if you're giving this transfusion therapy and eventually this particular parameter is predicting that the person is going to recover in next 2 or 3 days, we would reduce the number of transfusions which will go to the patient. Oh. So keeping that in mind, the study was undertaken, and Dr. Aditi and Dr. Tina were the ones who actually looked into it very aggressively. And they came out with the information that this particular parameter, the IRF, seems to be relatively an earlier predictor, which has also been proven in other studies previously. The only reason perhaps why we wanted to do here was that because, the issue was that from the country, there was no such data available so far. And importantly, since we do such a large amount of transplants and we need to ration the blood products, we needed to have this on board. And that's where Aditi did her job. Sorry, Aditi, I had to take your...
sorry, sir.
Is there any percentage jump do you expect in IRF, you know, to predict this bone marrow recovery? You have mentioned that. But
ma'am...
Yeah, my dear.
Ma'am, actually, in 32 cases, we saw that most of the cases, there was a IRF and IPF just got doubled. There are only few cases that they increased more than double of their values. So if the IRF and IPF got doubled or more than doubled, then we can expect recovery within 3 days of that jump.
Oh, thank you. That's great too. So Dr. Sujay, may I hand it over to you, because there are so many questions and we are just getting stuck. We have to go on. Thank you very much for your quiz. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Anita. It's clear that when it comes to, am I audible?
Yeah, very much, very much.
Okay. When it comes to platelets, there are more questions than answers. I think that is what is coming out. And as I see questions coming in, I have a few that I have selected for asking. And the first one goes to Dr. Rathod. Who had a very interesting study to share, and whether it's impedance or optical, obviously there are differences. My question to Dr. Rathod is, of all the thrombocytopenia cases, what percentage were evaluated using the optical? Were all cases of thrombocytopenia reported using optical, or did you select cases that were reported by optical?
Yes, sir. Sir, first of all, I want to say that from our experience, we had observed that in absolutely normal conditions, the CVC data from impedance method is giving an accurate result. But in pathological conditions, there is much interference seen. So it is necessary for the patient as well as clinicians. So we have to use both the method in a balanced way and make a protocol for the same. We had made just protocol that in every peripheral smear examination, we have included CBC diff data along with the all retic channel parameters compulsory. So because whenever clinician demand peripheral smear studies, then we should think he must require details of blood smear for the diagnosis. So by this protocol, we have very good number of database, and also we identify many difficult cases which we might miss out if we run only in the impedance method.
Yeah. My question is, not every lab has...
Sir, I'm not audible you. Hello.
Can I?
Now, sir,
you want
voice
me to repeat?
Is now coming.
Yeah, not every lab in the country has optical.
Yeah.
So what would your advice be to labs that have only impedance as technology?
Sir, we have made a reflex criteria. So according to the reflex criteria, if the platelet count was less than 50,000, Then another criteria was for the RBC, when there is a RBC is less than 3 million or MPV more than 12 femtoliter, or there is a flags like platelet abnormal histogram or platelet clumps. In all these scenario, we have to do the optical platelet count.
Okay. Okay, thank you, Dr. Rathod. Thank you very much. That was a very interesting study. I would like to direct my next question to Dr. Amrita. It was an interesting one because for diagnosing many, of course, for evaluating prostate cancer versus benign prostatic hyperplasia, you have used platelet indices along with PSA. How soon do you think this would be used by labs across India for reporting along with PSA?
Actually, what I would like to say that this is a very small study. And with the previous literature, it was basically, you know, a stimulus to decide to go for such kind of a work in a hospital setup like Sir Gangaram Hospital, that even a simple parameter like MPV and PDW can actually contribute in a, such an important diagnosis and differentiation from a benign, from a malignant condition. So I am really not sure as of now how much time it's going to take, but it looks promising that whatever data results we have got, there is definitely an indication that one should look in a larger group of cases. And also the one of the limitation in this study was, this is basically a study of a DNB resident from urosurgery, and it is still going on. He is recruiting more patients, but whatever data was collected till May this year, we could analyze that. And then it gave us a pointer that it's a worth, you know, putting that much of effort, getting patients and seeing their results, also coordinating their values and analysis with coexisting parameters like what I mentioned in my presentation, with like if there is a coexisting evidence of prostatitis and what are the histopathological grades of adenocarcinoma in these cases. So I think these are the limitation. The most important limitation here is the smaller sample size. So I think it's such a important point here that with such an inexpensive and a simple parameter, if that can play a role in future, it is definitely going to add to the diagnosis and a better management at a lesser cost.
Thank you. I think that's very interesting to know, because practical challenges in labs in India are the fact that we are unable to combine results coming out of chemistry lab with that of coming out of hematology lab. Okay. And make sense of it in a particular report that finally goes to the clinician. Thank you, Dr. Amrita, for your answer.
Thank you. Thank you.
My next question is to Dr. Shanaz Kodaiji. Madam, it was wonderful hearing you on the platelet indices in cardiac disease. My question to you is, so labs will look up to using this parameter. So if a small or a medium-sized lab were to start reporting indices for cardiac cases, for them to standardize, what would be the optimal number to get their indices standardized?
That would really be difficult to answer, in the sense we'll have to take a statistical opinion on what would be the correct sample size, because this is we are predicting something which is going to be very useful and I think clinically very useful. So we would have to take a proper sample size. But before I answer this question, I want to make it clear that I have not carried out any studies on any platelet indices for cardiovascular risk. So, it looks very promising, and I think it's a way to the future, because MPV has more or less been established as a parameter which can not only predict the risk but also, you know, predict recurrence and things like that. It can actually monitor different stages of the disease. So I think everyone needs to evaluate these indices. And the beauty of these indices are that they are so easily available on CBC analyzers, you know, with just with the run of the CBC and immediately, almost immediately available to us. So that is why the importance is even more in all the other applications as well, even including sepsis and infection. And as Amrita says, in prostate cancers versus benign prostatic hyperplasia, so they're so easily and early available to us. So the sample, coming back to the question of sample size, I would start with a sample size of 60. You know, 60 patients, 60 control, and maybe a group of 60 other patients who are recovered, or you know, some other group like that. And I would go ahead with that.
Thank you, madam. So would you see this as a sensitive marker or a specific marker?
Both, I should think. It is sensitive. It should be both sensitive and specific.
Yeah.
And as such, we don't have a marker that predicts that. You know, we have isolated markers like PROPTI, which just predicts MI. So I think these markers need to be extensively studied in all different stages of diseases, in the risk factors, and you know, many many studies will be required. Many studies are there to establish also that PDW and MPV have been good markers, and some studies even for IPF. So IPF is also emerging as a marker, which is.
So we can expect a lot of studies in this area, as well as newer, probably calculated or derived markers going forward from the cell counters.
Oh, I should think so.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, madam.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
Yes, I think MPV is useful, clear. The article from Shu, the meta-analysis with all these studies is clear. It was another study in venous thromboembolism, also clear. But also there are studies like Dr. Bowles using MPV for the differential diagnosis of central thrombopenia or peripheral thrombopenia because destruction. It's clear for me that platelets become bigger when they are activated, but also when they are younger, and maybe when they are dysplastic. In myelodysplastic syndromes or thrombocytopenia. I think we need to also check not only groups of acute myocardial infarction groups that are with destruction of platelets in the periphery, but also use this MPV random in the general routine and to see how combining the optical, the forward scatter, side scatter, fluorescence, we can help to differentiate between activated platelets, young platelets, dysplastic platelets. And I think this is a challenge we have, all of us, to, and maybe you have some comments to do to this comment that I am doing, but I think using artificial intelligence and using prospective studies, but not only looking for a special diagnosis, but applying to the general routine will give light to this, because it's clear that it's useful MPV, but how we know when we don't know nothing about the patient, if it's emergency room or is the routine, how we know if it's are activated, young or dysplastic?
Yeah, I think you are right in the sense that platelet counting and measurement techniques have become very standardized. What is going to come in the future is, like you rightly said, artificial intelligence tools that will combine multi-parametric approach to provide insights into disease-based values. And I think that's my view on that. Dr. Shanaz Kodaj, do you have any comments?
Yes, I do think that platelet indices and platelet parameters have a huge role to play in many, many disorders, and that they are much underutilized right now and they should be taken forward. I think there should be many studies across there. As Raymond says, already there are enough studies to prove their importance and their clinical significance in cardiovascular diseases. But also in many other disorders, they do have a large role to play. Especially now, I think IPF has become a more refined parameter. So people say that, you know, why MPV and not why, you know, why IPF should be better than MPV. But clearly, IPF is more sensitive in picking up many, you know, the size of the platelets, the internal granularity, the structure, the reactivity. So I think all these parameters together have to be researched much more to be made relevant. And even something like PDW, which we used to not look at before, has gained some importance in cardiac diseases. So Yes. All of them put together, I think, should be a good thing for all of us to study.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, madam. I think with that, we'll move over to the next session, which is a very interesting one because primarily it's a debate. I would invite Dr. Naveen Kakkar onto the virtual stage, who along with Dr. Anil Handu would be participating in this debate. Now, though it's called a debate and the topic is platelet measurement technologies, I would look at it more as a conversation between two eminent pathologists who have worked extensively in this field. And the common outcome out of this will be a clearer understanding of the way forward when it comes to platelet measurement. So keep in mind that this debate, there are no winners. Everybody is a winner because what we learn is what we take home. So with that, I leave the stage, virtual stage, for Dr. Anil Handu and Dr. Naveen Kakkar to debate on platelet technologies and help us understand that better.
Thank you, Dr. Sujoy. Is my screen visible?
Yes.
I think I'm getting a message.
Your screen?
I'm sharing, but I think I'm just getting a message of host disabled.
Yeah, yeah. We are seeing you.
Are you seeing my PowerPoint?
No.
Okay, I think the host needs to enable my screen.
Okay. Yes, I think the instructions have gone for allowing it to be shared. So till the screen comes on, may I know your approach to this debate? What are you likely to cover as topics, okay, not telling us the outcome of the debate though?
I think before we discussed about the debate, me and Dr. Anil a few days back actually decided. So there is no sparring, there is no fighting over this. The topic is such. It has be a workability between different instruments and the morphology. We can't leave morphology. Everybody believes that for platelets, and Dr. Handu's statement, search me, is the same. Okay, I think my screen
Sir,
share.
Yes, sir, we are allowed. So just check again, sir. You can now share your screen.
Okay. So is the PowerPoint visible now?
Not yet.
Not yet. Let me go back. Yeah, I'm still getting a message of host disabled, so somebody needs to enable my screen share.
Again, sir, I think so. There was a glitch. 1 second, sir.
One of the things with platelets is, I think the instruments, automated machines that use technology, I believe they are extremely sensitive, but they are not specific. And morphology helps us to be specific, but we miss out on it being sensitive.
True.
So I would think it's a great team effort between the technology and the manual morphology.
Yeah,
so if you have the technology now allowing you to share the screen, you can start.
No, still not working, but anyway, I'll continue chatting. So I think this is one field where morphology is not going to be obsolete for a long, long time. And I'm getting a message of screen sharing now. Yeah, hopefully we'll do that.
Sorry for the glitch, sir.
No problem. So visible now?
Yes.
Okay, so I'll begin. Don't have too long to go, 10 to 12 slides, and I'm going to overlap and leave it on to Dr. Handu to give the finishing touches. We've actually pre-decided the outcome in a way. So I'm going to talk about the technology that I was familiar with and worked with, and Dr. Handu will do his part and leave it with the morphological punch. and the link between platelets and appendix, right? Has anybody heard of that? Okay, may not. So there's actually a topic on PubMed, the appendix, little organ, big trouble. And I believe your platelets are similar. A little cells with big, big trouble. So I'm going to talk about going on from a three-part to a five-part and then a six-part analyzer, just overlapping the histogram patterns and the problems we expect and why. Just on pictures, no text at all. So that's a histogram for RBCs and that's platelets. The instruments give us these two histograms very separately in all instruments, but in effect, they are the same because this counting is done in the same chamber and they're just isolated or separated by thresholds and the size differences. So the smaller cells are labeled as platelets and the bigger cells go into the RBC zone. And obviously you will have differences when you have fragmented RBCs, they can fall into platelets. And when you have large platelets, they can fall into the RBCs. A few thousand, a few hundred platelets into RBC count of million doesn't make a difference, but your fragments coming into platelets or giant platelets being left out of the platelet count can make a major difference. I'll just give you an example on a three-part analyzer. This patient had extensive burns. So if you see your RBC histogram, there's a shoulder here. The shoulder is your fragmented and small RBCs. And if you see the height of the shoulder here, it actually matches very well with the tail of the platelets. So it's actually there where these cells are falling and being counted as platelets there and interfering in the actual count. That's typically on a three-part analyzer. The basic impedance is still all machines will have. That's three histograms from a three-part analyzer. Just want to focus on the last three, that's the platelet histograms. This is particularly normal, although you do see a trail of some large platelets which are falling, but still, overall a normal histogram, you get a normal count to like 11,000. Look at these two now. They rise well, but they are not touching down into their own zone. They're actually crossing over to the RBC zone. So this is a lot of large platelets interfering with the platelet count. So platelets will be undercounted here. 42,000, 65,000. These were actually cases of macrothrombocytopenia. That I'm in Himachal now, and we are starting looking at these cases here. So you talked about East India, donors in South India. We've had a study from Punjab in North Indian population, and now we're picking up in Himachal. So not an uncommon problem, but yes, underdiagnosed. So the issue here is your histograms. They are large, going on to the high volume zones, not dropping down, telling you there are lots of large platelets which will be miscounted. Look at their MPVs, 10, 12, and the normal one, 9.3. You can argue not much of a difference except for the 12 one. And that is because the bigger RBCs, the bigger platelets, sorry, which have crossed over to the RBCs, do not contribute to your MPV estimation anymore. So you can actually get near normal MPVs when you have the largest platelets, contrary to what we think. Okay, so this area, actually, this is typical histograms that we are seeing now for patients who have macrothrombocytopenia. ITPs do not give you this picture. They will have something like this with a slightly longer trail, that's it. This is an image I picked up today morning from Dr. Reena Das's presentation. In fact, one image that she sent to Ash Image Bank. They're just talking about a patient with sideroblastic anemia. I want to focus on these two histograms, platelet and RBC. So a sideroblastic anemia with enough microcytes, very small microcytes, and you're getting giant platelet flag and the dimorphic reds. Now, leaving this complicated graph to make it very simple for you, this is your RBC histogram, that's your platelet one. Is there a connection? Let's see what. So I put it in the different order and it actually connects very well. So your platelet histogram, you're getting those smaller RBC interfering in your counts. They are not, and the platelet counts are not dropping down because it is finding RBCs in the same volume. So this is actually a connected histogram given to us separately, but we need to make sense of all of this together. So you know there are smaller RBCs now masquerading as platelets. Now going further, when you talk about the impedance histograms, the three parts give you a very clear single histogram. The smooth curve is what you see in this, the black line, which ends well below 20 femtoliters. This is your regular platelet count. Most normal platelet counts will end there. You start from about 2. You don't have a threshold for 0 because that's noise there, electronic noise. And they'll drop down somewhere between 10 and 20, definitely. More than 20 means there are large platelets. And in that case, the machine creates a fitted curve. This usually goes beyond 20 to about 70 femtoliters. What does this do? The purpose of this fitted curve is to extrapolate information from other data. So it goes to your WBC channel and picks up any interference there. So if you're getting any clumps or platelets interfering there, it is going to collate that data and give you possible hints on the correct count, or at least a flag to say you need to look in the smear carefully. Now that's a normal one. Now, a completely normal one will actually have only one line. But here, because you have a population going beyond 20, the machine generates a fitted curve and tries to give you a good platelet count as close to normal as possible, and looking, taking care there are no errors in the WBC or other channels. Look at this one now. Your volumes are hardly going beyond 10. So this is severe thrombocytopenia. Count was 5,000. Very small platelets. Most of them are small. Could be Viscot Aldrich. You need to see the MPV. Maybe about 6.2, 6.8. Could be Viscot Aldrich, but in correlation with your clinical profile. Not the number alone, not the histogram alone. Two more examples of large platelets. This one, again, so in the LH, it actually cuts it off at 20, doesn't allow it to go, which means till here it is counted, and then you have to see the smear and counter check. So this means there are some large platelets which have to go somewhere here, while this means many more large platelets because the platelet histogram is way up there. So if you actually do a hypothetical follow, it'll probably go somewhere like this and then drop there, expecting that this count is likely to be undercounted for platelets, and you need to do a correction looking at your smear. Coming on to the ADVIA count. Now ADVIA uses the my theory. So what does it do? It spheres all your red cells and platelets by an isovolumetric sphering. So in that, what happens, your platelets which are discoid, maybe indented, are actually converted into perfect smears and then analyzed. And it uses a light scatter and the staining, the MPO staining for WBC, but a light scatter and the laser for platelets and RBCs. So what are these zones here? So this is where you get your density of normal size platelets. So if you see, even there's a variation. No two platelets are alike. This is your area. Number two is for large platelets. Three is for red cells. Three is actually a zone out of this count because that's also estimated similarly, but volumes are different. Number four is red cell fragments. They are pushed way below. And five is RBC ghosts. Again, those analyzed RBCs, membranes remaining. So if you look carefully now, this is normal platelets and this is large platelets, and this instrument will actually account for large platelets to a large extent. So it'll give you a platelet count which has large platelets to a good extent, not those falling in the range of RBCs, because they will be actually going into the RBC zone. But still a good number of large platelets are picked up by the ADVIA. So this is where the white platelets that you see, or the white dots, is the normal size platelets, and that's your giant platelets. And the instrument will actually flag for you. It'll say large platelet flag 1+, 2+, 3+, depending on the number of giant platelets. And they are flagged when they are more than 10% of the population in the system. So that's the blood smear. Now, remember, we tend to overdiagnose the large platelets when we report sometimes. So adequate count with few large platelets, we tend to write that pretty often. Large platelets is a larger platelet, yes, but a giant platelet is what approximates the size of an RBC. So in this smear, probably this comes close to a slightly slightly larger platelet, not giant platelet. You would probably ignore this and say this is all normal. Look at what happens in a patient with macrothrombocytopenia, which seems to be the flavor of the day. So look at here now. This platelet seems normal, but if you go back compared to other ones, it's either similar to this or larger than most others in the last smear. And the other ones are almost approximating RBC. Some of them are larger than the smaller RBC. This is a patient with macrothrombocytopenia. And this is on the plots on ADVIA that I'll show you now. Just two more slides. Just want to focus on the platelet counts first. So this patient has 76,000. It plots the platelet volume with refractive index, because RBC wouldn't have a similar refractive index. So 76,000, 1,96,000, 4,81,000. So on the higher side, completely normal and thrombocytopenic. Look at three plots. Your number of dots is less, because obviously the number of platelets counted here is less and more here. But if you see a common pattern, there seems to be a density in this zone. There seems to be a density in this zone, and then the dots scattered all over the place on the higher volume zone. What happens in macrothrombocytopenia? Now, the scattergram here is a patient from secondary thrombocytopenia, possibly because of sepsis. This one is a patient with ITP. Look at the platelet count, 76,000, 79,000. Similar, what you see is again a density in the lower zone. Very, very typical of secondary and thrombocytopenia or even ITP. Now, two patients with macrothrombocytopenia with a count of 68,000 here, a large MPV, platelet count of 1,13,000, again an MPV of 13.13. But if you see now, the density is missing. You see, these two, in spite of the thrombocytopenia, still maintain that density, which means the number of large platelets compared to the rest of the population, not that much. While here, the scatter seems all over the place. You can't find a density in one place. This is very typical of macrothrombocytopenia, the optical estimation by ADVIA. We tend to over-report giant platelets and mention large platelets in our reports often. But the histocatograms tend to make more sense than morphology at times. So just a final slide that marries the three part with the LH and finally the Advia. Macrothrombocytopenia, macrothrombocytopenia, macrothrombocytopenia. Very different looking patterns, but they're talking the same language. Bigger platelets, more than the size of RBCs, same here. And here again, the platelets that have gone here and probably into the RBC zone will be the ones missed and undercounted. And like Dr. Sangamitra mentioned, it's very, very important to identify this condition at least, because you're going to do, we have had bone marrow was done, aspirinectomy considered, and lots of patients started on steroids considering ITP as a diagnosis in these conditions. And the platelet histograms can actually help you a lot. So we need to work together with the counter to sort this out. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Naveen Kakkar. May I invite Dr. Anil Handu?
Thank you, sir. And thank you, Dr. Naveen. That was really, really nice. And I am afraid that there'll be a few overlaps here when I'm going to talk about it. And as has been already fixed up by me and him, there's nobody who is a winner. So we have already fixed up the winners between the two of us. And even if I lose or he loses, we'll still share the booty. Okay, so I'll be sharing my desktop now. So if the administrators could allow me to share my thing. The prelude to the presentation has been pretty good, and Dr. Naveen has already very nicely pointed out what are the all issues which are there with platelet counts on two different analyzers. And I'm going to pitch in with the subsequent analyzers, which I have had some experience on. The first point that I would like to mention here is very clear, and that's platelets, they will always remain controversial. I was saying this in the morning as well in my talk, and I don't differ anymore even night at this point of time. Now, the techniques for platelet counting predominantly can be differentiated into two main groups. One is your automated methodologies, which may be semi or fully. A lot of us are preferring to use fully automated methodologies. And I'll be continuing that, after where Dr. Naveen has just left us out. And then the manual methods, which I'll just share with you, where my thoughts about it. Now, we know that the reference method today for platelet counting is very clear. And it is on flow cytometry for sure. So you use the flow cytometric counting reference method, wherein the RBC and the platelet ratio is taken into account. Of course, you use the CD markers, which are 41 and 61, which specifically identify platelets. And you do a flow cytometric platelet count and give us a reference vis-a-vis the RBC counting. And this was way back in 2001 that ICSH eventually gave this methodology. We also know from what Dr. Naveen also said in his presentation that you're basically looking at impedance-based counting, where hydrodynamic focusing plays a very, very important role. And eventually, there is also something called optical flow cytometry-based counting, where you're using two-angle scatter devices at two distinct angles, low angle and the high angle scatter, and eventually counting cells with or without fluorescence parameters into it. Now, if you look at in general from various vendors which are there in the market today and you have all these instruments available, you will see more or less it's a combination of an optical or an impedance methodology which is involved, and some of them are also involving the immunology. The MindRay analyzers incidentally have similar as what you have from SysMix, etc., where there is an optical and impedance methodology involved. Now, the impedance and optical-based automatic counting, a little bit of it has already been discussed, and I will be adding to the same. Dr. Kakkar has given you a very nice presentation already, where he has talked about how the RBCs and the platelets are in the same channel, and that can give us problems. And I will be talking a little bit more about fluorescence and optical-based platelet counting. Now, this is a very, very important picture, which some of it has already been emphasized by Dr. Kakkar as well. What happens is you need to remember that you have an RBC channel, and in that RBC channel itself, you're counting the RBCs, you're doing the hemoglobin estimation, and you're also looking at the platelets. So the simple funda is that the platelets and the RBCs are being counted in the same channel. Now, he showed this previously by the graphic depiction, and I have just put in analogies here. The thing is, platelet counts are in thousands and lakhs, whereas an RBC counts are in millions. It's like comparing a bucket of water to a sea. So if there is a drop of water which goes from the bucket into the sea, it makes no difference. But on the vice versa, if there's a bucket from here and getting into the bucket here, it'll create a lot of furor. And that's what happens when RBCs and platelets are taken into each other's compartments. So this is what has been shown by Dr. Rathod also, and to a large extent by Dr. Naveen in his presentation as well, how RBCs and platelets overlap, and these large platelets and smaller RBCs or microfragmented RBCs can give rise to problems when you're trying to differentiate between the two. So if you look at evolution of RBC and platelet analysis, it was impedance along with that hydrodynamic focusing, which came out eventually. And subsequently, people started looking at optics, looking at refractive indices, which in ADVIA group of instruments, Dr. Naveen showed. And of course, you also have similar kind of an optic involvement in Abbott instruments. And subsequently, you have impedance, optics, and to add to it, you have hydrodynamic focusing, and then you have fluorescence. When you combine all of them, this is how it will come in front of you. Now, optical and fluorescent platelet count is what I'll be talking about a little bit. So if you look at it, you have nothing but a laser-based detection of platelet counting. What you're trying to do is using the lasers, focusing it onto the cells, and then trying to see the light refraction from them, picking it up by photomultiplier tubes, as well as the photodiodes, and then analyzing it, converting it from digital to analog to digital signals, and analyzing it on the instrument. Now, the moment you add fluorescence to it, it becomes a fluorescent platelet count. And what does fluorescence do? The fluorescence starts picking up the RNA or the DNA material which is present within the cells and gives you a separate distinct picture on a scatter plot, and you're able to differentiate between various cell types. Now, this is important because it suddenly gives you a differentiation mechanism between the platelets, which are smaller in size. So if you start putting it on a forward scatter, looking at the size and at the same time trying to put it against the fluorescence, you will have very distinct patterns. This is from Abbott instruments, where you have only the refractive indices which are taken into account, and you're looking at the development of the scatter plots. This is from ADVIA, which Dr. Naveen has already shown, so I'll not really get into details of this part of it. But what is important is that there are algorithmic approaches which helps you to differentiate between various cell populations. And if you observe, you are able to identify giant platelets separately, your microcytic red blood cells separately, and very clearly you're able to identify the fractions, obviously, on this platform as well. You can also differentiate between the platelet particles, the platelet clumps, which somebody was talking about and was wanting to get an answer. So there are instruments which are able to identify these platelet clumps, but unfortunately, you will not be able to numerate them. You will not be able to get the counts appropriately from them. So there are issues with the impedance platelet count, which I already mentioned previously as well. And therefore, basis that, we need to look at something which can give us better platelet counts. And the answer to that was the fluorescence platelet count. And if you see what happens is, on the forward scatter, you have these cells which are differentiated very clearly from the red cells. So you have red cells over here and you have the platelets over here. And in this also, you have another component which is called the immature platelet fraction. I did talk about it in the morning, so I'll not really get into details of it now. But what suffices to say is that immature platelet fraction is here to stay, and it has helped a lot of, given us a lot of information, especially when we're dealing with patients with dengue, where IPF gives us information whether to transfuse or not to transfuse. And this stands published by a lot of people. I am fortunate to be working with someone who was the first to do it along with her team in Mumbai, with Dr. Kudaiji, Dr. Kunal and others, where they demonstrated how IPF would be able to give us information and decide whether we are able to need to go for transfusion or not. You need to define your reference ranges, and that's what I'm showing you in this particular slide. This is one of the slides which Dr. Tina, who works with me, had shared with me, where she'd shown that in a dengue positive case, how the IPF was. The IPF was pretty high. And in her study, which was eventually published in the International Journal of Laboratory Hematology and went on to get awarded in a lot of places across the globe, in this particular study, she very clearly demonstrated how the IPF keeps increasing and while the platelet counts keep going down. And the moment you have the IPF which gets stabilized, your recovery of the platelets is just bound to happen, and that comes out the next day. And this actually gives a lot of information when dealing with patients with dengue, and it is very, very useful. Okay, so IPF in dengue is a potential tool which helps you to predict recovery of platelets, and it also helps to make sure that you don't need to transfuse such patients. Of course, she had given us an indication of 10% as an indicative of platelet recovery, which has subsequently not been found to be the correct methodology. In fact, the stability of the IPF is what is far more important. Now, coming to automated immunoplatelet counts, when I say automated immunoplatelet counts, I'm only trying to add what is called the true platelet count component into the picture. Why? Because you are now adding the CD41 and CD61 to your analysis, and you are almost resembling or making it akin to what is done on a flow cytometer. Now, this is available only on one instrument, which is from Abbott Diagnostics, and they use a 41-61 parameter. So if you see, This is the parameter which they are showing you here, and eventually based on the optical on this immunoplatelet counting, you are able to get the so-called true platelet count. But the moment you try to do this, it's very expensive and it takes slightly more time than the usual, and therefore has not found place in the routine practices across the globe. Now, coming to something which is a slide-based automated platelet counting. This is controversial because somebody would say you're saying slide-based and then you're saying automated. How does this happen? So there is a very interesting thing for the morphology buffs amongst all of us. I have seen a lot of people would not want to budge out of morphology. And this is what I call digital printing. And I'm not sure how many of you have heard about it. This is from a vendor, Roche, where they have come up with an analyzer where they use what is called the digital printing of blood drop onto the slide. And then eventually there is a high definition camera which takes multiple images for this, just like in a cell of vision. And eventually you get this pictorial diagram over the computer. And from there, you are able to analyze the platelets, the red cells, the white cells, etc. And you're actually able to get accurate hemoglobin, accurate platelet counts, accurate total WBC counts, etc., etc., etc. So you really don't need to worry that, can you do it? Can you do a platelet count? And you will even be able to pick out your platelet clumps, etc., on this kind of a platform. The only problem with this is that, one, it is not really readily available to most of us. And number two, the throughput of this analyzer is pretty low, obviously, because the slide has to first be printed, dried, and then subsequently stained, and eventually a photograph to be taken and then only to be counted. And of course, as you can imagine, that this would also be akin to a lot of issues which can come up because of the staining issues, because of drying issues, etc., which can potentially give you problems. So that's why it's perhaps not really seen the order of the day or the light of the day, at least in India so far, though there are neighboring countries where this is already available and a lot of people are using it, of course, in a setting where they are using and this as an add-on analyzer to their existing analyzers. Coming to a manual platelet count, I just wanted to add this because all of us talk about, especially when you work in a hospital-based setting, a lot of your clinicians get used to you writing on the reports manual platelet count or this platelet count has been verified manually. And then the next day you will get a request for asking for a manual platelet count alone. Now, what do you actually mean by the manual platelet count? What is recommended is to use a Newbar's chamber. I'm sure a lot of us would have gone through this in our pathology training and even in physiology when we were doing MBBS. And then, of course, you use the platelet diluting fluid. And once you have done that, you have to charge the chamber, start counting on the RBC counting area, and then these last five counts. And then, of course, you have these recommended formulae which you have to put in and count the platelets manually. Now, this is what we really do. We don't do what I just said. Majority of us just take a peripheral blood smear, stain it with usually with only Leishman or sometimes with GIMSA or sometimes with a combination of both, and then subsequently put it onto the microscope and count the platelets. And once you count the platelets, you average it out in the 10 fields and multiply by a factor. And that's where the biggest problem starts, because all of us get taught different factors at different places. And we start giving counts which are different. So what one needs to remember is, when we do this counting, there are lots of issues with manual platelet counting. Why are there issues? Is because there are, first of all, the slide is not standardized. You do not have a standard methodology of making a smear. You also have a field of view of the microscope, which is important. Just imagine, if the view is smaller, the number of platelets in the field will be lesser. And if the field is larger, you will have larger, more number of platelets within that field. And you multiply the same average number by the factor. So you will have different counts which are coming into your picture. So for example, if you look at this, let's say the factor is 20,000, 15,000, 12,000, and 10,000, and you're counting the same number of platelets always. That's the average count was 8. Now remember, when you have a factor of 20,000, your platelet count will be 1,60,000. Whereas when you have a factor of just 10,000, your platelet count will be 80,000, just 50% of what somebody would have given at a factor of 20,000. And this is what happens in dengue season, at least in India. Everybody gives different counts because they average it out differently. Their platelets are, this is not a standardized technology or standardized methodology. And there is a huge variation between the individuals as well. Now, this is where we need to be very sure what we are trying to do. The idea of doing a manual platelet count on a peripheral smear was just to identify the platelets, counts by, on a smear, compared to what was being found on the analyzer. It was just supposed to be a reference check, but this is where we have led it to. And we need to, I'm not trying to say let's not do it. I'm saying let's do it, but let's do it the right way. Let's make sure that we have identified what our factor is for our microscope that we use in our laboratory based on the counts from the analyzer, and then use that particular factor when we are doing it. Every time when we do a manual platelet count, we must make sure that we have a smear which is of good quality. So if I may summarize, you know, you look at platelet counts across various different types of analyzers. I have just shown you one of the presentations, one of the publications which has been there from India, and there are many others from India as well, from my center in Delhi as well, and this is from Mumbai where Dr. Tina had worked, where they found, you know, if you look at the fitted platelet counts from the LH750 impedance counting, or you look at optical and other fluorescence-based counting, they're almost similar. There is not much of a variability, but the moment the counts are on the lower side, or low platelet counts, you start getting challenges, or every time the platelet count is much higher, you know, going beyond linearity, you start getting problems. So if I may summarize further, ICSH standards reference method is flow cytometry, and that's here to stay. Automated platelet counts are reliable, and this is something which I would like everybody to keep in their mind, because a lot of people just don't want to believe the analyzers. Precision does get affected at lower counts, and of course beyond linearity, and we need to be conscious of that fact. And in such cases, the algorithms which are set in your analyzers need to be adapted according to your practices. And optical and fluorescent counts do provide advantages in certain disease-specific states, but it may not be that, you know, optical or the fluorescent count is just the panacea for all the issues which you have with platelet counting. And remember, impedance, optical, fluorescent counts, etc., whatever you may call it, they have comparable CVs for normal counts. But when it comes to, lower counts or counts which are going beyond linearity, the CVs may be very, very variable. And you also need to remember, when you're running your samples into the analyzer, the sample integrity and transport should have been correct and good. So all in all I can say is the debate is won by none. It is a very simple process. We need to have a comparison of all the technologies which are available in your system. And as Dr. Rathod had mentioned in his presentation, it is an algorithmic approach, which is very, very important. None of the technologies can be good, better, or ugly. We need to have a combination of all of them together to give the right platelet counts for right patient care and right treatment. Thank you very much for your kind attention. And I would end with this slide saying that it is the man behind the machine which is the most important factor. And you need to take decisions which are useful for the fraternity, for patient, and for treatment. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you, Dr. Anil Handu and Dr. Naveen Kakkar, for that wonderful conversation. It is very clear, and if I may summarize, the knowledge that we have gained is that both automated instruments with various techniques as well as the manual counting methods are important. But the wisdom comes when we know which of those samples that has run on the automated cell counter needs to be evaluated manually. And I think each lab has to define those criteria that helps them evaluate the smear. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks. With this, we have reached midway in our day two of CUBE 2020. And I would like to thank our esteemed chairperson, Dr. Anita Sudnarayan and Dr. Sujay Prasad, along with our esteemed speakers, who made our day learning field.